Thank you. If you appreciate the tuning so much, I hope you'll enjoy the playing more. Thank you.
You got your troubles, come on, get happy. You better chase all your cares away.
What's more boring than a queen doing a Judy Garland imitation?
A queen doing a Betty Davis imitation.
Hello, this is Rock Hudson, and this is my story. It's a love story.
It's a disease story.
No, it's a love story.
It's really a disease story.
No, it's a love story.
It's Stop. A disease. You're both gay.
Hey, that's not funny.
This story has the three S's. Sex, sodomy, scandal, and sodomy.
Wait a minute, you said sodomy twice.
I like sodomy. I like sodomy.
Well, you said that twice.
I really like sodomy.
Ooh.
My story begins as a young boy, before my name was even Rock Hudson.
Mike,
yes,
come down for dinner.
Oh, yes, Mother, I'll be right there as soon as I finish my tongue twisters.
Tongue twisters? Hurry, Mike.
Yes, back then I was Mike Crack. I was very popular. Everybody loved my crack. No wonder I'm gay.
Mike, hurry.
Yes, Mother, as soon as I finish practicing my tongue twisters. Buddy butts, butts, butt, breaking his buddy's buns, but buddy's buddies never break buddy's butts, butt.
Mike, please, why do you practice these strange tongue twisters?
Because I'm too young to hustle, Mother.
Ow.
I grew into a man and went to Hollywood. Little did I know, for the next 20 years, my backside would become a parking lot. A literal dartboard for the stars.
Mike, you've got talent.
But I can't act. I can't dance. I can't
sing. But have you ever wondered what it would be like to be tied spread-eagle to a bed while a man wearing only a leather jockstrap talks dirty to you?
Yes, I was thinking that on the way over.
You're hired.
Ooh!
Sign here and kiss me full on the lip.
Yes, sir. Yes, I was on my way. But first, I needed a new name.
You gotta find a name.
Wait a second.
It's exciting.
Rip. How about
yes,
rip?
I like it.
Rip intestines.
No.
How about Dick Schmo?
No, I'm not going to...
Harry. Harry Bottom.
No.
Bob Offen.
Bend Over.
Peter Swallower.
Randy Wetfist.
Phil Asiel.
Harry Anus.
Emo Nitrate.
No.
How about this one? Phil McCrack.
Shadow.
Ooh.
Shadow Steven.
It was hard finding a name. Finally, we came upon...
I got it.
Yes.
Rock Hudson.
Rock Hudson.
Ooh.
I like it.
I like that a lot.
It has dogmatic energy.
Yeah.
What's the significance?
Well, once they find out that you're gay, they'll hit you over the head with a rock.
Ooh. Yes, I like it.
And throw your dead body in the Hudson.
Yes. My career skyrocketed, as did my KY jelly bills. I was very busy and so was my tuchus. My new movie was a success.
Oh, Rock.
Yeah.
Take off my bra.
Oh, Doris.
Mm.
Ooh. Oh, I love your luxuriant hair.
Thank you.
Your hairless chest.
Ooh.
Your abnormally wide hips and feminine buttocks.
Yes.
Your sloped and rounded shoulders.
Oh, thank you, Rock.
Who's talking to you? I was talking to the cameraman.
Oh, Rock. Oh.
I began to get nervous in the 60s when rumors abound about me and Gomer Pyle. None of it was true, of course. My true love was Sergeant Vince Carter.
I can't hear you. I can't hear you.
Oh.
I still can't hear you, Pyle.
Not Pyle, I'm Rock.
And I'm Steel. Get me my poppers.
Well, all hell broke loose. I had a laundry list of lovers. It was said that I had Liberace and Montgomery Clift, but I'm not one to kiss and tell. Well, I did put the moves on Lassie. I also wanted Buffalo Bob Smith and Jimmy Olsen, but they weren't gay. My most treasured memory, though, was Larry Fine of the Three Stooges.
Hey, Rock, is that your mother's lipstick?
No, but it's my dad's nipple clamp.
Hey, how did you trick me into this bed?
This stooge thing isn't gonna last forever, Larry. You better take it and like it.
I'm warning you.
Yeah?
I'm putting on my clothes right now.
Oh.
Blow away, you old fairy.
Larry turned me on and turned me down flat, as did Uncle Milty, Victor Mature, Walter Cronkite, and Ed Kooky Burns. But then it happened.
Rock? Rock, is something wrong?
My lungs... They're dangerously filled with fluid, but nothing is wrong, I assure you.
Then why are you rattling? Your sheets are soaked with sweat.
Oh, I'll be all right.
Here, Rock, eat this olive.
Why?
I want to give you a bath.
Why the olive?
So you don't slide down the drain.
Get the phone, get the phone, get the phone!
Hello?
Who is that?
Rock, it's Linda Evans on the phone.
Ugh, what does she want?
She says she's going to be late for tomorrow's kissing scene.
Why is that?
Because she's getting fitted for a helmet.
Oh, God! Oh. Yes, I was dying.
Listen to that cough. Rock, we must get you to Paris.
Why, do they have a cure?
No, we want to push you out of the plane over the Atlantic.
No! Oh, at least Mark Christian left me. Where is he?
He's out counting your assets and stamping your passport.
No! That was it. That was my story. I told him to bury me shallow so my friends could stop off for a cold one. My publicist, Glenn Schwartz, tried to hide my disease.
Excuse me.
What did Mr. Hudson die of?
Botulism.
Are you sure?
Yes. Bad meat in a pie.
Mr. Schwartz, why are you making bad jokes?
Because all I have left for clients is Richard Basil and Emo.
No. And that's my story. The Rock Hudson story. God bless.
I'm jamming with these guys, and I'm writing a song.
If I could, I surely would. Stand on rock and move school. Whoa, boy, don't you lie on the track. 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 See my lady sitting in the shade.
Morning radio show can be heard here in New York City, Philadelphia, and everywhere there are guys who make those kind of noises. Yeah, he also has his own television program. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Howard Stern.
Exceptional opening to the show today with the Rock Hudson story and the Aerosmith song in studio. Thought it was excellent. Yes. Did you play any movie clips?
I can tell you a couple.
Did you play the Joe Pesci one? I know you played that yesterday. Yeah. Gary went and got some new movie clips for the opening of the show. You know which ones I like? Hey, Fred, why don't you, you don't have those, do you? Those movie clips?
I can get them.
Yeah, some of them are pretty good. I want to hear some of them. On hold, I have Captain Jenks. Seems we were mentioned on the Larry King show last night by Roseanne and Tom. Roseanne Barr and Tom
no,
Arnold.
Roseanne Arnold.
No. I don't think so. No, Roseanne Barr and Tom Barr. It was pretty funny, actually. I saw it. Did you see it?
Pretty nothing, though.
Yeah.
Nothing.
Larry,
you know, no in-depth interviews about what her father actually did.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I thought it was pretty funny what she, what he said about me.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Considering his career.
And what, see, Larry was trying to get rid of the whole association. Tom wanted to address it.
Yeah. Okay. Listen, it's 6 past 6 o'clock, 92.3 K-Rock, WYSP, WJFK. I got to take a short break just so we stay on, you know, on top of things. I don't want to fall behind this morning. So we'll take a short break here, and then we'll come back and start the show for you. We've got a couple of things going on today that I think you're going to like. And we'll be back right after these words.
The date is set. Classic rock and roll all day.
There it is. And you don't have to go through those embarrassing situations of checking out some guy's education and how many years he's been in practice and what his specialties are. So it's nice to know that wherever you go, with one phone call, 1-800-DENTIST, can find a dentist that is just right for you. So if you need a dentist and you want to make an educated choice, call 1-800-DENTIST. Okay, let me just get Captain Jenks on the phone here. Captain Jenks?
Yes, sir. good morning, Howard.
That was Celeste who called Larry King.
Matter of fact, it was, Howard.
I recognized the voice.
See, I had to be at a WYSP listeners' party. Hello?
Yes.
So I called Celeste up last night and asked her if she would possibly try to get through for me, along with asking a couple other people.
All right, let me hear it.
Ooh, cool.
Alexandria, Virginia, for the Arnolds. Hello.
Hi, Roseanne and Tom.
Hi.
Hi. I'm listening, Roseanne. I want to know if you and Tom will ever tell the, or use your comedy specials, to tell the world how you feel about Howard Stern.
Well, I have no idea what that is.
Oh, it's the guy, it's this DJ, second-rate DJ from New York.
Oceanside, I think it's Ocean.
Second-rate DJ. Well, I'm proud to be a second-rate DJ from New York, because whatever, what is he, a second-rate guy who marries women so he can get on TV? Boy, it's embarrassing how he's sort of like taken over a career, and he talks over
all
her.
All the time. You'd think they were asking him questions.
I know.
You'd think he was molested by her parents.
I know.
Roseanne looked pretty sick, too, Howard. She looked like she was...
If you had Tom Arnold on top of you, you'd be sick, too. Hey, but, you know, the thing is that he's actually looking kind of handsome now. He lost some weight and stuff.
Right.
He'll be ready to leave her soon.
He lost 100 pounds.
Yeah. Well, you know, he does everything like a fanatic.
Yeah.
Did you recognize Celeste's voice when you heard it on the air?
Yeah, I heard it. As soon as I heard it, I said, not as soon as I heard it, but as soon as her question was over, I go, oh, that was Celeste.
Well, now that you said it, it does sound like Celeste.
Yeah, it is.
But I heard it on the fly, and I was like, oh, somebody got through.
Yeah.
But did you hear what Larry was saying? I don't know, dude. I don't know who that is.
Did you hear he was like, you don't understand. Oh, don't worry. Don't worry. Roseanne knows plenty well who I am. You can be sure of that. She's pretty obsessed with me.
Yes, remember that one time you sent the pizzas to her room, Howard?
Yeah, hey, Jank, seriously, man, that was stupid.
Yes, I know.
I hope you stop doing that.
Never good, huh?
I got blamed for that. He thinks he's so effing funny, sending pizzas to my room. I said, I didn't do it.
Yeah, but she doesn't know that.
Yeah, right. She doesn't know Captain Jenks is on the warpath. If I say something negative about someone, Captain Jenks takes them on as enemies and starts running around like a maniac.
I think he has to do something about it.
Yeah, right. He has to take up my cause. They need you in California. You can start there calling those two idiots, Mark and Brian.
Yeah, I phoned them a couple times already, Howard.
What happens when you call them?
Well, I call up and I pass the screener, and once they put me on the air, I get on and I just rank on them about you. I asked them last time, how's it feel to be Howard's little bitches, and that actually got out on the air.
Right.
And they were a little upset about that.
Why? Why would you be upset about being my bitch?
No, yes, that's what I said too, Howard.
So this is really weird. Roseanne and Tom are on Larry King, and I just started laughing when I heard the question. And I started laughing at his response, and I'm a second-rate DJ. It's just kind of funny coming from a guy who's...
What has he done?
Yeah. Oh, that's right. He did an HBO special, but he got it after he married Roseanne Barr, and we all saw that. I mean, if I'm second-rate, then...
At least you're second-rate on your own.
Yeah. I've gotten here on my own. You know, I'm a DJ, I'm second-rate, but I'm here. I'm doing something that, you know, I created.
You're not Howard Barr.
Right. Exactly. I didn't have to marry my wife and, you know, and ask her if I could be on her TV show. And he's horrible.
Oh, you know, there were things that our children,
yeah,
when we raise our kids.
Yeah, I mean, this is a guy who just got into the scene.
They've known him about 3 hot minutes.
He's a real dangerous guy in that respect. He has no clue that he has nothing to do with this.
We're lucky we have money.
Yeah, right. We have money. Did you hear that? We're lucky we have money. You know, he's saying, well, not everyone can afford a therapy after they realize their father molested them, like me and Rosie, because we're lucky we have money. But you can get therapy because we have money. Just because we have money, you know, every minute we have
money. Yeah, our children.
Well, that's good. He could bring those tapes into court when he has to go. They'll be divorced. You'll see. There'll come a time as soon as he's feeling like he's got something going on his own.
But, you know, when I start to resent a guy for calling somebody else's children his children,
yeah,
can you imagine how the children feel?
Imagine how the real father feels. Yeah, and she's giving out how to mothering tips.
Yes.
That's pretty dangerous.
Well, that's what I say with all these people. You know, like, her first book was supposed to tell women how to be women. And she was already hiding some big secret that she wasn't dealing with herself.
Right.
Did you hear Larry call Roseanne lovely and talented?
Yeah, I could see maybe talented, not lovely. I mean, if she's lovely and talented...
I don't think Larry would have hit on her in a commercial.
No, I think that's a pretty safe call. Hey, I tuned into that Hard Copy show. They didn't have Larry King picking up anybody.
Yes,
they keep
that.
Saying, now it's tomorrow, or today. Now it's today.
They
promote it for today.
Oh, okay. Because I didn't even realize what... I just lucked out and got on that channel. I go, okay.
is that not supposed to be Larry picking up some woman?
Yeah.
Is he, like, sitting around a room with his shirt off?
No. Actual tape, though. Actual audio tape, I think, of him picking up a woman. I have a transcript of it. Because it was in Spy Magazine. Where is that? Larry puts it...
Hey, Mo.
Hey, Larry. Oh, here it is. King. Do you have to go?
Excuse me.
Let's see when this happened. How does it... All right. Hey, thanks, Jenks.
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you.
Cool, cool.
All right. Bye-bye. I don't need him on the phone when I do this. How does a famous 57-year-old open-heart surgery patient maintain his reputation as a womanizer? This is from Spy Magazine. By working at it. That's how. Not long ago, Larry King's talk show host was interviewed by Lisa Bradfield.
So not long ago.
Right.
When was this magazine published? This is recent?
1 month before hearings on his fifth divorce were to commence. So I guess technically he was, you know, separated.
He was separated.
As it happens, the divorce never took place. Unconcerned with the reporter's running tape recorder, King conducted the personal seminar on how to pick up girls.
So he didn't even care. He knew a recorder was going.
Right. Right, so obviously there's a whole bunch of interview and then, you know, then he starts in. Do you have to go? You want to interview more on the phone? You want to come back tomorrow night? I don't really know yet. I don't know what I'm doing yet. You're loose. Well, I guess you could call it that. Are you glad you came? Yes, of course. Yeah, she's there to interview him, of course. I'm glad you came. I like you. I did want to interview you. I wish it hadn't been a piece, you know, without a specific assignment from a newspaper or magazine. No, he just did a blind interview.
Because the girl was good looking.
Well, who knows? I mean, I'm
speculating.
Me too. But, you know, you don't know. Well, whatever it was, if I didn't like you, I wouldn't have done it. I wouldn't have done a spec piece, but I like you.
See?
Yeah, a spec piece. He's so important, he can't do a spec piece. I mean that. I don't say anything I don't mean. That I don't do. That's one thing about reaching this age. You hit a point where you don't have to say anything you don't mean. Oh, he's like George Burns.
Now he's learned something.
Why do you look so perturbed? Do you want to stay? No. Do I look perturbed? Yeah. I didn't mean to. I don't know what I want to do. Do you want to come back tomorrow? So then the next day at 5:30 p.m. at King's condo, he answers questions on many subjects, and he has a terrible cold. So she says to him, you must feel crappy. Have you gone to a doctor? What I have, he says, is the cold. And it happens to be a bad cold. And you feel like hell? I don't feel like hell. I look worse than I feel. You look okay. You've just been coughing and sneezing a lot. I look like I have a cold. Are you coming over to the show or are you going back tonight? Well, so far he hasn't really picked her up.
No, he hasn't done anything so far.
I'm not sure. You want to come over tomorrow afternoon? I have to speak at a dinner tomorrow, but I don't have to go until like 7, so if you come over around 4, it would be perfect. We could have 3 hours. This is for a journalist who doesn't even have
She doesn't even any place to put
She has nowhere to put this magazine article.
Oh, my God.
She called him up and said, listen, I want to write an article on you. He said, what paper? She goes, I don't have a paper. I just want to write an article on you and hopefully sell it to somebody. And you never do anything like that.
And this is the third interview he's going to give her.
Right. Do you think I should come over then instead of now because you're so beat? You mentioned how beat I am. Why don't I lie down and you come back tomorrow? Maybe I'll be 100% better. Well, I doubt it. Then he goes, you're single? Well, yeah. How would I know? Are you involved with anybody? I have an ex-boyfriend. Do you date older men? Oh, here he goes.
Oh, boy.
I date all different ages. He was 30. That's only 4 years over me. That's not older. Oh, that's not older. I dated a 35-year-old guy when I was 20. Well, you're bright, attractive, and a little ahead of your time. I actually think I'm just the opposite. Dull and unattractive and slow.
And behind her time.
Do you know what I mean? I know what you mean. I like you. Is it okay to tell you that? Yes. No, I mean I like you. Thanks, you're a nice guy. You're a nice girl. I bet everyone tells you you're a nice guy. You're used to hearing it, right? I wouldn't do this for anyone. Well, I'm very aware of that. Because I don't do interviews for spec articles. He goes into that again. Generally, I have refrained from doing any of this. But there's a quality about you that I like. If I can ever be of help to you, let me know. Thanks. No, I mean it. You're very nice. What's another word? Romantic. You're laughing at me.
Romantic? Where'd that come from?
I don't know. He just
threw that in.
She's not catching on. Yeah. He's going, I like you. I like... No. What's another word? Romantic. No, I'm laughing because you're saying this and you look like you're ready to pass out. You mean I don't look amorous? Well, you look like you're ready to pass out. I'm sorry. I'm laughing. I'm not laughing at you. I'm tired. I have a cold, but I'm telling you nice things about yourself. Well, it's like two mental patients talking.
I'm telling you.
Well, that's nice. I don't know what to say. I'm going to go lie down. See you tomorrow. Okay. They head for the door. So does a nice girl like you have a date for tonight? No, I'll probably go back to my hotel room and read a book. King smiling. Are you a lesbian?
Oh, God. Because if you don't want to stay with him, obviously, you must be.
Any girl who doesn't stay with Larry must be a lesbian.
You know, when she doesn't have any other date.
Are you a lesbian?
Is that really in there?
Yeah. Oh, you thought I made it up?
Yeah.
No.
It sounds like a perfect Howard Stern line.
It's not that much of a pickup. I mean, it's a pickup, but it's not that much
Are
of a
Are you
pickup.
A lesbian?
I thought he was going to be more direct with her. Like, hey, come on, get in my bed. Bang me.
Well, I mean, he was hitting on her.
Right. He's romantic.
He just wasn't picking up on it.
Right.
If he had picked up, he'd have gotten a lot further.
She was playing dumb. She's not that dumb.
Do you date older men?
Man. Man. Shooter. Mmm. Mmm. Frankenstein. Mmm. He did everything but club her over the head.
Oh. Are you saying I don't look amorous? I don't see how Larry King could look.
Yeah, right. Good looking guy like that. With those suspenders. I like that look, the suspenders.
That barrel chest.
Yeah, yeah. What is that chest?
That is from years of smoking, that chest that
Oh, is that what happens?
Move. Sure.
Wow. Oh, yeah? Is that what does that?
Oh, yeah.
You mean you can develop a chest like that if you smoke a
yeah.
lot?
Yeah.
I know if you pump iron, you get one kind of chest.
Right. That's the smoker's chest.
It's great. I was watching that Steven Seagal movie. What was the one that was just in the movies?
Hard to Kill?
No, Out for Justice.
Out for Justice, okay.
He walks like he's got a stick up his ass.
Always has.
Yeah. I mean, you think a guy who's into karate and stuff would sort of be loose.
He doesn't look like he takes care of himself
no,
well.
No, does he?
He looks a little sloppy.
You know what else I saw last night? The Red Fox Show. Did you see that?
I saw the first one. I didn't see last night.
It's Amos and Andy. I mean,
with a woman.
Yeah, I mean, it's the Amos and Andy show. And you know, they say Amos and Andy can't be on TV because it's racist. But it's Amos and Andy. Red Fox is as stupid as Amos and Andy. How you doing, Dado? He goes to the principal. He's a big, dumb, retard Red Fox. And they're asking him questions like, If you're going to ban Amos and Andy, then you should ban the Red Fox Show. That's all I'm saying. I mean, out of all the shows in history that have been banned, Amos and Andy is less offensive than Red Fox. So Red Fox goes to the principal's office because his grandson is accused of cheating.
Uh-huh.
So they're testing Red Fox because Red Fox claims he coached him. So they go, all right, tell us about the McCarthy era. Well, McCarthy, he was with John Lennon in the Beatles. So this is the caliber of the writing. And I'm not saying I didn't laugh. I'm just saying that if you're going to ban one show, you got to ban them all. How could black people sit there and go, well, Red Fox is okay, he's cool. He's as offensive to anybody as Amos and Andy ever were.
Well, Sanford and Son was the same thing.
Yeah. I mean,
he was always getting into these harebrained schemes and winding up losing the money and having to be saved by his son.
I'm not sure exactly why Amos and Andy is so offensive and Red Fox isn't. No, I'm just not sure. Because even on Amos and Andy, they had all the other black people were, intelligent and spoke clearly.
Right, had jobs and, did very well.
It was just the Kingfish who was like, Hamdi, Hamdo, Dabby, boy, but they all ran their own businesses and they were pretty upstanding people. A lot more upstanding than Red Fox, in that show.
Yeah, the thing about Amos and Andy was everybody else, they were like typical people. They were doing things.
Right.
They had families. They had lives.
Yeah.
And none of these other shows do the blacks have any life.
Everybody's just hanging around.
To make jokes.
Yeah. They're all jokers. In this episode, Red Fox was out sick from being a postman for 3 days.
And with that walk, he could walk a route and deliver mail.
Well, he went bowling that night instead of tutoring his son. That was the whole concept.
Ah.
And then Red Fox is sitting and watching Jeopardy to try to study for the test. And they ask when the Magna Carta was signed. And Red Fox goes, a long time ago. That's the answer.
What is a long time
what
ago?
And then he hears the answer, 12:15.
Uh-huh.
And then he goes to the school. And the same exact question they ask him, when was the Magna Carta signed? He goes, 12:15. He knew it. But it's Amos and Andy. And the dopey grandson with all the stuff carved in his head.
Yeah. And I've always said the Jeffersons was that same stupid concept.
With, right.
George Jefferson being the village idiot.
Yeah.
Red Fox has always played the village idiot in any of his TV series.
Yeah. I just feel kind of bad for the people who were Amos and Andy because they probably could have collected a whole bunch of money from those reruns. Something. Or at least work some kind of fame into it.
I think they're all dead now.
It's too bad.
Moot argument.
The shows are funny. I think, anyway. I mean, they're definitely sort of racist, but so is Red Fox's show. But 630, 92.3 K-Rock, WYSP, WJFK. Want to take some phone calls?
Sure.
And then I'll tell you what's going on. Because we got a lot of stuff going on. And you know what?
See what's on people's minds this morning.
Yeah, exactly what I'm into. You're on the air.
Hello.
Dude.
Howard.
I dropped another pound, Robin.
Good. That's 8.
Hey, listen, Howard.
To be honest, it's 7.
You told me it was 7 the other day.
I know. I lied. It's only down 6.
Howard.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, I just wanted to say I think it's absolutely ridiculous that Larry King and Roseanne and Tom Arnold sit around calling you second rate.
Well, Tom Arnold called me second rate, but Larry King is just as pompous. He's like, Larry King thinks he's more happening than me. Larry King's never gotten a rating point in his life. Nothing in his career so far has achieved any ratings whatsoever. He's on CNN with a 1 rating, which is lower than any Jessica Hahn show that they buy a half-hour infomercial on. Jessica Hahn is a bigger star than Larry King. He gets a 1 rating on any given night, and he basically does an overnight talk show that isn't rated. And he's got an article in USA Today, and that's something that isn't evaluated or rated. Who knows who he is?
Yeah, but what does he actually say in that article in USA Today?
He says nothing. He rambles on like a mental patient, but he's made some snide and pompous remarks, and stuff like, for what he does, he's the best at it. It's like, what I do is get on the radio and talk the same crap you jerk, except that people are interested in what I have to say. Don't act like you're in some other business than me. Larry, you come on in the morning and compete against me. We'll see who what you do and what I do.
Howard.
Nobody gives a rat's ass what you got to say. You could have all the Tom Arnolds on the air all the time.
Howard.
Two bores.
Howard.
But for Tom Arnold to sit there and call me a second-rate anything, I mean, it's ludicrous.
Well, listen, Howard, I just want to say that I've been listening to you for close to 10 years now.
Thank you.
And I've thoroughly enjoyed your show. And the reason I'm calling now is because my company is relocating me out to Chicago.
Oh.
And this is going to happen next week, and I don't know what I'm going to do.
Well, I'll tell you something. The good news is that this show could very easily be on in Chicago within the next couple of months.
Well, I want to champion your cause out there. I think, you know, I've been out there many times.
I'm talking to three different, right now I've narrowed it down to just about two radio stations.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to get us on in Chicago. That's a dream of mine. And I'm also looking at Detroit.
Good. Good for you. I mean, I think Chicago would be a great market for you. That Jonathan Brandmeier out there is a waste
Johnny
of
B on the loose.
Johnny B will be more on the loose.
Johnny B, we said Johnny B on the noose. He'll actually be hanging himself if I come out there. Right? Johnny B on the news?
Fantastic. I think you do very well out there. And I'll tell you what, I'll be the first one to champion your cars out there. And as far as L.A. is concerned, how's it going against that Mark and Brian?
Well, we don't know yet. Everybody keeps asking me the same question.
What are we supposed to say?
We don't really have any ratings information yet. I mean, we were on, we had 1 month of ratings where we were on for 3 weeks, but it doesn't really register anything yet. For some reason, I don't understand that, do you? I don't understand why they don't know instantly.
They always lag, so it's not instantaneous with Arbitron. I don't know what they're doing.
I don't know what they're doing, but I think, you know, my prediction is we'll do very well out in Los Angeles. I just can't imagine. I heard some tapes of that Mark and Brian show, and it's just real bad. It's just no content. It just sucks. It's two imbeciles. And you know what? Maybe if you're from Los Angeles, you can tell. I can't tell which guy is which.
No.
On the radio, I mean, there's no discernible way to identify Mark or Brian. And then there were a bunch of other guys who talk, and you just listen, and it's just babble.
Yeah.
It's just like meaningless, childish babble.
I was out there on business, and I was doing some traveling, and I got stuck in traffic. And I was searching for a radio station, and it just got to the point where I had to just turn it off.
Yeah. Los Angeles radio is real bad.
There's nothing to listen to out there.
Rick Dees is horrible, but he had everybody scammed for a couple of years. He was the first one to get his ass out to Los Angeles. Get your ass to Los Angeles. He went out there, and he was pretty smart to do it, actually, because there was nothing going on. I mean, all it was guys playing records. There was nobody talking, nobody doing anything. So,
wacky.
In fact, it was my plan for us to go to Los Angeles, Robin, but at the time, we were tied up in defeating the evil forces at NBC.
We were very busy.
Yeah, but I had met with some guys about going to Los Angeles, but in fact, I had met with the ABC guy, Bill Summers.
Mm.
That's the guy who now is the boss of Mark and Brian.
Mm.
They wanted to hire me, but I was unavailable because we were, of course, working at it. But we were coming here.
That's right.
Hey, listen, Howard, one other thing.
So I went and had a meeting with him. And he was like, oh, please come. It'll be great. And I said, well, how about some money? You know, we got a show. It's not only me. It's Robin, Fred, you know, and various other people. Jackie was sort of quasi with us at that point, you know.
Well, we would have made the trip without Jackie.
Yeah, I mean, we definitely would have left him behind, but you know what I mean. We were thinking of bringing Jackie on full-time.
Yeah.
I said, you know, there's a whole budget involved in this, Bill. And it was like, well, you know, ABC only has so much money, and, you know, it's sort of built in, and blah, 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 blah. And I just said, okay, forget this guy. He came up with, like, nothing.
Yeah.
Mark and Brian couldn't be making much.
Well, you know, that whole we had just done that corporate thing.
Yeah. And ABC would have clamped down on us and, you know, made us all sucky and boring. So, you know, I didn't want to have 97 lectures a day about how we can be funny without talking about sex or talking about drugs or talking about anything.
Mm.
You know, I don't need lectures like that.
Absolutely not. It would take away from you. I mean, you have the perfect medium. It would be a waste of time for you to get on the network TV. By the way, I think your show on Saturday night is absolutely hysterical.
Thanks.
I mean, I almost wet myself when I was watching that female feud.
You almost wet yourself, or you did wet yourself?
Almost. I was laughing so hard. That was absolutely hysterical.
Thanks.
Those were real
I was on the phone all yesterday with the TV guys.
Oh,
Yeah.
I don't know. Things seem more confusing since we hired an executive producer.
Oh, boy. Everybody keeps asking me how that's going, too.
Well, I don't know. It's just like, well, his big thing is, his big way of handling the TV show is once you set things down, what you're going to do.
You don't change.
You don't change, which I can dig that, and that's basically what our problem is, but I'll tell you, you know, if I don't feel like something's there,
you got to change
it. I got to change it. But I don't know. You want to know what? I'm too tired to do battle with that whole thing, so.
Hey.
You know, it's sort of like either you have a full-time TV job or you have a full-time radio job. I don't know that you can do
both. I'm almost afraid to ask what's on the show because I know it's not what we talked about on Monday.
Oh, you should see what I was pulling together yesterday. Hey, you know, I like to do mind-blowing shows, though.
That was mind-blowing.
Yeah. Well, you know what? My plan is this year. I'm going to do a lot of female feuds, a lot of lesbian dating game, a lot of the cool stuff that people really dig.
Yeah.
That way I don't have to knock my brains again, you know, like every week trying to do something brand new. I'm going to take a lot of the stuff from last year and then just like take it 9 steps further. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Which will be cool.
Keep it up.
That's my plan for this year. But I can't even seem to make that happen. I don't know, you know. It's just real weird. Then we got Tony Bennett coming on, and which is kind of cool and everything for our show to get a Tony Bennett, but he's got a whole bunch of rules and regulations. He doesn't want to be in a sketch. He doesn't want us doing anything weird around him.
What does he want to do? He wants us
to sit down and talk to him. So that's what I'll do. I mean,
you got something to ask him?
I'm going to think of something to ask him.
Where does he get his $2 rugs?
I'm going to ask him how. I'm going to say, time has not diminished your beauty. I was thinking I could just whip off my shirt and dance topless. I don't think there's any restrictions on that. So he's got a whole bunch of rules and stuff. But, okay, that's cool. I mean, he says, hey, look, I only want to come on if you follow these rules.
Wow. At least he's being up front.
He's a big star.
They come with the rules.
Yeah. It could be funny just seeing us sitting there with Tony Bennett. You know what I mean? Just the idea that we could even sit there with him.
Should we dress specially for the show?
Yeah, maybe we should. Hey, and I didn't even think of that.
Yeah, maybe, you know, we're interviewing a Tony Bennett. Maybe we should be in evening clothes.
Yeah, maybe you should wear evening gown and I'll wear my tux. I only had a tux. The only tux I have is the one from Family Feud.
Oh, dear.
Oh, that's a classic. Yeah. Did you get polyester rash on that with that?
Believe I did. All right, dude, I got to go.
Hey, listen, it was good talking
to you.
All
right, bye-bye. I just couldn't take him anymore. Was he getting on your nerves?
Yeah, I knew you were about to bail out of him once before. He had good stuff. He was just...
I don't know what it is.
A little bit
weird. I start talking about something, and then he just was interrupting a lot. But I guess that's the point of calling in. But he really didn't have anything that special to say. He just was complimenting us.
Yeah, but he let us into something.
Yeah. But Los Angeles, that guy who works at KLOS, is that the station Mark and Brian are on?
Yeah.
Yeah. That guy tried to hire me, Bill Summers. He's still there.
Still in what position?
He's general manager.
Okay.
And quite frankly, I knew. I said to myself, that's the problem with like an ABC station. You got to deal with the general manager when you want to get hired. You can't deal with a general manager. You don't know what he's doing. You got to go to the president of the company.
But in a corporation like ABC,
you can't. There is no president.
30 people between you and the president.
And there's no way the president meets with anyone. And quite frankly, the president's just another schmo whose money isn't on the line. I say that I always knew that NBC, ABC, CBS could not really have successful radio divisions because they've got a bunch of people running them whose ass isn't on the line. It's not their money.
Yeah.
They're running stations that basically nobody really owns. You don't know who owns
them. Yeah, if the station makes $30 million or $2 million.
Nobody cares.
That's right.
Why else would Grant Tinker fire me? Grant Tinker fired me from NBC. Now, if that was Grant Tinker's radio station, he had NBC AM making zero money with no ratings. I come in, bring him up to a 5 or a 6 rating. He's making money. You think he would have fired me? No way. His attitude was, well, if we have to make money that way.
I don't want it.
I don't want it. And I'm like, well, you know, hey, that's because it's not your money. Oh, believe me, if it was his radio station, he would have been kissing my feet, licking them wet, and then drying them with his hot breath. Trust me on that. What a dink. Same thing with Bill Summers. Oh, I don't know if we can afford it. Well, you want to win? That's why I want to kick their ass Bill. I'm going to show you what a winner's all about. You know what you did, Bill? You couldn't get me, so you told two guys, go listen to my tapes and pretend to be Howard Stern. But don't do anything too outrageous. That's what you did. I know exactly what you did.
Probably sat in a room with him, said, don't do that bit. Do this bit.
Right, right. Well, I'm in control of my own fate here. And I'm going to kick those asses of the two little pussies you hired. What do you think of that? I'm all fired up. 6:42, Robin. I got to take a break.
All right.
We'll be back right after these words.
Stern all morning. Classic rock and roll all day.
Hey, I'm glad. I'll tell you why. Because some of that stuff I got a feeling is killing a lot of people. All that chemicals and junk. I like Snapple. That's from me. That's what I give my kids. And that's what you should give your kids. Snapple should be the number one soda, iced tea, sports drink, and natural juice on the market. They should be number one. There should be very few other companies in existence.
Yeah.
Think about it for a minute. Take a look at Snapple Mint Iced Tea. Nice, refreshing drink. Everybody says it's the best on the market. But anyone
all
who
natural.
Tastes it, all natural. Forget it. Snapple, made from the best stuff on earth. Thank you. If you look for Snapple products, and their new bottles with that big, wide mouth, 33% more than their imitator standard size. More fluid. Oops, missed. No, I don't, because Gary came in here and said he'd called Andy out in Los Angeles a couple of weeks ago and told him to start running commercials, you know, to put in the phone number for 1-800-52-STERN, but Andy forgot because Andy's so busy.
Oh.
And then Gary tells me that Ken Stevens over in Washington, our general manager at the, WJFK, is not even playing our commercials for 1-800-52-STERN. He has told everyone to stop playing them. He hasn't played them for months.
Now, what's that all about?
I don't know. Gary, get me on the phone, the guy who runs my show in Washington. I just want to know, do they run my commercials for my CD or not?
Because doesn't Ken Stevens run both those stations, YSPN?
No, he just runs the Washington one now.
Oh, I see.
And the Baltimore one, whatever that is. But we're not on in Baltimore.
No.
At least not yet. I'm trying to get us on in Baltimore because I know that would be very special to you because you're from Baltimore. I want to do something nice for you.
Oh, well, thank you, Howard.
So you know who you're talking to. This is Tom, the guy that did all those great interviews with black people in Washington.
Oh, Tom. Tom, who knows how to infuriate black people. Tom, you're on the air.
Hi, Howard.
Hi. Do you run my commercials for Crucified by the FCC?
Yes, I do.
Oh, you do?
I just ran it. I was chastised, though, and asked why I was running it. And I told Ken I was instructed to run it from New York, and he said that he's my boss.
Oh, so you're not running them?
I just ran one anyway.
Oh, you just ran one now? But, I mean, for the past couple of months, have you been running them?
Occasionally. But, see, the thing is, when you do them, I'm trying to follow our log, and sometimes you'll stop the tape or whatever, and then I get back.
I almost never stop the tape on 1-800-52-STERN. That was the first time I've ever done that.
Yeah, well, you just did this morning, right?
That was the first time. Yeah, right. So then you stuck with us.
Yeah, I went with you, exactly.
Hmm. How'd you know to go with me, though? How'd you know I'd stop?
Because I listen to you and Q in one ear constantly.
Oh, I see.
You know, but Ken asked me why I was running it, but I do run.
But I don't understand. Why would Ken ask you? You know, and I don't want to get you in trouble or anything. I just want to know why we are not. In other words, you're saying you were given orders not to run commercials for Crucified by the FCC.
Right. I've been told two different things.
And I'm telling you to run them.
Okay, I'll run them.
Yeah, Tom, let me tell you something.
Who's your boss?
Tom, I know you think Ken's your boss, but let me tell you something. If I wanted to, I'd get rid of Ken in 2 minutes. I could get rid of him so quick his head would spin. He don't know it, though.
Well, are you going to get rid of Ken before or after he gets rid of Tom? Because
see,
that's
the problem. He'll probably get rid of Tom today, and I won't even have a chance to get rid of Ken. Let me tell you, it's such a, you know, corporate politics. What is the bug up Ken's ass about Crucified by the FCC? First of all, he is supposed to be running those commercials, unless somebody's lying to me.
Why don't we talk if there's a problem?
You know, it's really weird. I'm sitting there every day going pounding my head against the glass. I go, California. I wasn't even going to bring up Washington. I just figured we have no listeners in Washington or something. I said, gee, Washington, nobody cares about this. God knows what's going on in Philly.
Well, I'm carrying it, Howard, and especially during the...
Well, but I don't want to get you in trouble with your boss, but I know you've been given a direct order not to run it. I don't think that's right. And then you know what'll happen? Ken just come, oh, okay, I misunderstood. Meanwhile, for months now, they haven't been running the commercials. Now, why would Ken decide, out of all the stupid commercials Ken's run, let me ask you something, do you get the traffic reports? Do you get new, isn't half the time you're killing time and with music and all kind of crap?
Well, we've curtailed that quite a bit because he wants me to get back to you as quick as possible.
Yeah, but tell him, Crucified by the FCC is very important.
I understand.
Not to me, to his company. That's how they make money.
I understand that.
I don't even give a rat's ass about me, but there's certain people here are going to be very upset to learn that he is not running those commercials.
Okay, well, here's...
I'm calling for his firing. I am calling for his firing today. For Ken Stevens to be let go from this company.
Well, Howard, the thing we have to do is log this on the log that you send me from New York.
Listen, that's your problem.
You mean it has to be written in from New York?
So I know, you know, when to stay with you.
Uh-huh. No, wait a second. That's another kind of problem. But you were told not to run these commercials.
Yes, I was told.
All right, that's all I needed to know. Thank you.
All right.
And don't worry. Don't worry.
Don't worry.
You'll probably fire him.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You're
well, he didn't say anything against Ken. He's just saying, hey, I was told not to run them.
But, all right.
Tom does a very good job for us in Washington.
I'm hanging in there trying to kill the zoo, but they've come here.
Yeah, I know. What a bunch of dicks. Too bad.
Well, you don't have to be around when they're there.
I'm not. I'm telling you. If they touch anything that belongs to me, he's going right out the plate glass window.
There you go, pal. I like your attitude. See, Tom's with us, man. I dig Tom.
He's on our team.
Yeah. I don't know why, but he is. He just digs us. Yeah, they hired zookeepers.
Have you heard the promos they've got on the air here, Howard?
Let me hear.
I'll send them up to you.
Okay, thank you.
They're on the way.
Tom's a good man.
Well, Ken might fire you for that.
Ken could fire you for that.
I'm still waiting for a raise, Howard.
Let me hear the promo. Can you play it for me?
I don't think you can hear it over the phone. I'm going to have to send it right up to Gary. Let me get the engineer in here.
Well, maybe you can do it over the phone.
I can't. I'm a one-man operation here.
Take your time. Don't rush. We're just killing time anyway.
Geronimo says you should kiss his feet.
Is that what it says in the promo?
Yes.
What?
Yes.
Listen, I am going to tell you something right now. You know, Ken Stevens is going to be in for a grand surprise. You know what? I kept my mouth shut about this, but I'm going to say something right now. I don't want any friggin' promo from Don Geronimo to mention my name. That's a little fat jackass. I'll start talking about who he made love to. You'll all have a good laugh.
It's Howard Stern all morning, Don and my daughter.
Let me tell you something. I don't want any fat jackass mentioning my name who stole everything I've ever done, every ounce of creativity I had in my body. He took that fat little turd. He knows who's king. And let me tell you something. If there's any kind of crap being said about me, any kind of crap, he's off the station. Because I guarantee I'll win that battle. A needle dick rat bastard, I'll kick your ass. You just shut your mouth. Don't run those. Are those promos running during my show?
Yes, they are.
Let me hear it over the phone.
Okay, here we go.
You shut your mouth. Don't run
those. Let me see if I can get them there.
I was going to say, the promo sound like you.
Yeah, that sound like me.
Yeah, I'm going to have to.
Why is everybody working against me in my own company? Why is everyone working against me, not with me?
I'm not working.
Does Ken Stevens make money off of me? Is that how they pay his check? He can't run the Crucified by the FCC commercials. And I don't even know about it. I'm calling for his firing. I want him off. I want him out of the company.
I'll get all this stuff up through the satellite. Because there's no way to do it in this air studio. Right?
Get that on the satellite now, Tom. That's your mission.
I want
that satellite immediately.
You got it.
I'm standing by. Thank you.
Standing by to receive.
Kiss his feet. Those big fat feet.
Death to the zoo, Howard.
Tom, you just relax. You're not me, okay? I want you to keep your job.
I'll survive.
You know what? You're damn good. I'm going to tell you that. I like you.
You know, I live out in the country, so I just have to drive in here, deal with this, and then go home.
There you go. I like him. I like him, Robin.
I'm well aware that you like him. I just don't want him to lose his job. You know, you get somebody all worked up, they go out thinking they're you.
Right.
And then they're out of work.
You know, I bust my balls for this company. make sure we put out the best product possible.
Yep.
I love this company. I've proven myself to this company.
That I will say unequivocally.
And I think this company knows it. But I can't have people working against me. I just can't.
And I mean, we have enough problems. We don't need people inside.
I can't have some fat turd talking about me, especially a fat turd who had no act. And we know it. We were in Washington when this guy was in Washington. He was a top 40 disc jockey. Ah, Don Geronimo, yeah, baby.
And spin another record.
Yeah, spinning another record. Real creative guy. And suddenly he became me.
All of a sudden he found a personality.
Suddenly he's got balls. He's talking. He's telling off management.
He's wild.
He's a wild man. Listen, you wild man, I'll take your ass and throw you right through a window with Tom. You big fatso slob. You talk about me. You kiss my feet. Don't you run any promos about feet. The only feet that are going to be washed here with your tongue and mine. Gave you a whole career, you fat jackass. Nobody knew your name. All you little creeps. Sitting there going from town to town, getting fired from every radio station I ever worked at. Laying out the blueprints so lamos can have an act. Sitting there, man, married man, getting fired, acting like a retard on the radio, and getting fired for it. And every one of the little lamos is around now. All go crawling out of the woodwork, telling me I should kiss their feet. Don't you dare run that promo during my show! Where were these guys when I was getting fired? All these brave broadcasters. Where are they when the FCC comes after me? I don't see one of these fat slobs sitting and giving any money toward my defense. I'm doing it for all of them. Sitting here putting my career on the line. It's a career we're talking about. This is a guy trying to make a living. All these numbskulls can sit there and talk about me. The only thing I want to hear is accolades. Howard did this for me. Howard did that for me. I don't want to hear anything else. Especially guys working on my station. This is my station. I own this station. And you don't talk about the owner of the station in that way. Because when I leave this station, they're all going down. Trust me on that. Kiss their feet. And Ken runs that crap. Where's Ken Stevens? Come to me. Come to me now. Working, waking up in the morning, my station went country. Going to Washington. Sitting out to deal with that moron, Gopla Barr. And his buddy lawyer, sitting there dealing with Denise Oliver, said, this is how we're going to do it. You got to memorize the names of the high schools. Okay, Denise.
I knew this was coming.
What?
What are you talking about?
What are you
He's psychic now.
Who are you, Kreskin, Tom?
But I saw O'Mara yesterday, and he said he's going to get the ratings up to a 10.
Yeah, good, good. That's good. I hope he gets the ratings up to a 10.
And the good news, Howard, Surf is our new program director.
Yeah, I know that's good news. Okay. I like Surf very much. But you want to know something? I don't even... Screw Surf. Screw Ken. Screw everybody. With their 10. They're going to get the ratings up to a 10. With my ideas, they'll get the ratings up to a 10. I don't want any promo about kissing my feet. I'm going to kiss his feet, that fat, disgusting slob.
You'll have these within the hour.
I need those within the 15 minutes.
Okay, well, if you let him off the phone, he could give them to us.
Exactly.
Just keep the phone open. Go do whatever you got to go do, and I'll continue talking.
Cool.
Go ahead. What's the matter with you?
All right.
Because I knew that's why we weren't getting anything. He's sitting right there.
Well, this is a guy who's waited a full year for us to call him. See, I need a guy who is on top of things.
That's right. Somebody who tells us what's going on.
I like this guy. And I don't want a hair on his head touched.
What is that?
I'm just crazy from, you know, I don't mind when the competition sabotages me. I don't mind that.
But
I understand it. I understand it. When Mark and Brian, you know, tell the ABC network, don't do this, and then they call the record companies and they call Dice Clay, I understand it. They're scared and they're shaking in their pants and they're trying to hold on. DiBella did it in Philadelphia. He was calling Dice Clay, he's calling that one. Meanwhile, he's gone. He's nothing. He's dirt. I knew he'd be gone. He's yesterday's news. But my own station. He should kiss our feet. You know, all the subjects to talk about. He has two new guys coming on the station. All the subjects
they're
to talk about. They're busy talking about me kissing their feet. This is what I mean. This is the level of creativity.
This is how stupid radio people are.
Ken, you just remember what your bread and butter is, pal. You remember who's sitting in the driver's seat. When my ratings are down, that's when you can take over, okay, Ken? I want a full report on my desk. I want a phone call now. I want to know what's going on over there. If I'm not there, I am telling you, the same thing with my TV show. If I'm not there, it's like morons running things. I'm the man in charge. You know why? Because I'm the only one who knows how to do it.
Well, what gets into people, though? Because these are obviously attempts at sabotage.
I know.
Why would you sit there and say, you know, I'm running this station. I get my salary if this station does well.
Yeah.
Why are they picking at you?
Yeah. I don't want any crap. I don't want my name mentioned. I want my name to be like the F word. You can't say it until I give you permission. Because Ken cannot use my name responsibly. That's why, you know what? I'm going to tell you something. I let something slide I shouldn't have. Ken put together a commercial down there in Washington. No one ever showed it to me.
Right.
For the Howard Stern and WJFK.
Yeah.
No one ever showed me the commercial. That I thought was interesting. I didn't know anything about it. I was kept totally in the dark. Finally, I heard there was a commercial running with me in it.
Uh-huh.
Well, if you want to see the most unflattering commercial in the history of television, why don't you go see WJFK's commercial? No one consulted me. Ken, what am I, being kept in the dark? What do you think this is, a game to me? This is how I earn my living. This is not some goofy thing to, you know, to you it might be goofy. To me, it's how I earn my living.
Okay. Is Scott ready?
Oh, okay. All right, well, Tom, why don't you go?
Here we go.
Where's he going?
Where are you going? Oh, he's working.
Hello.
What are you doing here?
I just thought I'd drop by and say that Donald and Michael are starting October 1st on WJFK.
I thought we left you at the last station.
No, I'll be here, Maurice Butkus, giving you all the sports that's fit to read.
Listen to Don and Mike, afternoons from 2 to 6, starting this Tuesday.
That's my out-of-the-closet Stern bit.
WJFK.
The butt cheeks thing, whatever that guy's name is. That's out-of-the-closet Stern. Yeah, and what else?
Okay, don't be shy. Do you know who Howard Stern is?
Yes.
What does he say about Daddy?
He says that he should kiss his feet.
Do you think I should kiss his feet?
No.
Do you think Howard Stern should kiss my feet?
Yeah. Don and Mike on WJFK.
Talking about putting your kid on the air. I did that all through, you know, Washington. Talking about my kids and in New York, I put my kids on the air. Same stuff, same garbage all over again about kissing his feet. You take your daughter, you and your foul-mouthed daughter, and take them both out of here. Take them both right off the planet, okay? Why don't you take a plane, a rocket ship to Mars, you fat slob? Why don't you sit your daughter on your lap and explain to her how you make a living? Ripping me off, you fat jackass! Why don't you take your daughter and explain to her how Daddy's so uncreative that he couldn't think of anything to do with his radio career except spin top 40 records before he got a hold of my act? Why doesn't somebody explain that to your daughter?
Why don't you explain to your daughter you should kiss his feet because that's the way she gets to school and eat?
Yeah, that's how you're actually getting that money from Infinity Broadcasting because of me, fatso. And don't accidentally...
Your daughter to be grateful.
Why don't you tell your daughter who you made love to? Don't accidentally take a bite out of her arm either, you fat pig. Should Howard Stern kiss Daddy's feet? Daddy's feet. Daddy's big, gross feet. Couldn't stand to smell your feet, let alone kiss them. Your poor daughter. What's her name, Pocahontas Geronimo? I don't want to hear your daughter uttering my name. You know the truth when you sit there. This is Percy Buttcheeks. What is that? Out of the Closet Stern. Started that in Detroit. Brought it to Washington when you were still spinning top 40 records because you couldn't think of anything else to say. Kiss my fat black ass, you idiot. Sitting there, do you? All right, okay, here's one from, here's one from Michael Jackson off the new album. Yeah. W. What was that station he worked for in Washington?
WPGC.
WPGC. Why don't we get a couple of air checks? What I was doing 10 years ago and what he was doing. I'm the god of radio, and you're a lowly worshiper. Not you, Tom. No, you too, but...
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, you're a disciple.
You're a disciple.
I'm going to have to call in a favor for Kingston now.
That's a little inside, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. That is such a... That's such an inside joke.
You want some more?
Okay.
Hello?
Hello, honey.
Yeah.
I have great news.
What?
I'm not at home.
Yay! Finally!
I'm not at home. I'm at my new radio station.
He calls the wife on the air.
No.
It's
good idea.
Rita, hi.
Oh, you're back together again.
Yeah, we are. And I just want to say we had a wonderful dinner out on the town the other night. And thanks so much.
Oh, thank you. I didn't mind at all going to the ladies' room and getting...
Hey, calling your wife on the air. That's a pretty good idea.
Out and chatting with y'all again.
That's right.
See, I got to think of that.
Gentlemen, this is America's favorite husband and father, Don Geronimo, and America's most queen.
I got to think of that.
Bachelor, Mr. Mike Sexhound O'Mara.
Hi there, everybody.
Our new afternoon show starts on WJ, almost at the other place, WJFK.
That's right, starting October 1st from 2 to 6.
Where are
and the
good idiots?
News is I'll be out of the house.
Two zookeepers.
And we'll tell you all about that dinner we had Saturday night where you really, really hurt Mike's feelings.
He's going to talk about his wife.
Afternoons from 2 to 6.
He's going to call her on the air. Gee, that's a pretty bold move. I wonder how he thought that up.
Hi, honey.
Hi, honey. It's me. The guy you married because I was on the radio. Because I couldn't get girls any other way. Big fatso. You're calling your wife on the air. Gee, I wonder if I ever did that in Washington. I wonder if I ever did that in Detroit. I wonder if I ever did that in Connecticut. You know, when I used to call my wife on the air, they used to. I had a program director who told me, don't call your wife on the air because it goes on too long. I mean, just calling my wife on the air used to get crap. Because nobody cares about hearing your wife. We didn't hire your wife. Gee, and they even promo all that stuff. You know, the problem is, I got to start doing some of my old stuff just to prove that I do it. I'm just sick of talking to my wife by the time I get to work. All right, Tom.
No more?
My heart is broken. Ken Stevens has broken my heart. I don't want any calls from Ken. Ken is dead to me.
Hey, look, we're still
Ken Stevens is... You're not dead to me. Ken Stevens is dead to me.
We're still doing the number down here, Howard.
What number?
Kicking ass and taking names.
All right, Tom, come here. we gotta call Tom once a week now. That's it. What are we doing? We're kicking ass and taking names?
Right.
I don't understand that expression. Help me out with that. You're kicking ass, and whose name are you taking?
Anybody that'll subscribe.
Come here, Tom. I got to do something to you now.
We got to put your head in a vice.
Yeah. All right, man. All right, thanks, Tom.
We'll get him.
Okay.
We'll get him.
Okay, bye-bye.
Oh, dear.
He's on the team, though, you got to admit.
I tell you, he's like a rabid dog.
Yeah, that's why I like him. Ken Stevens is dead to me. I never will talk to him again. I will never want to be in a room with him again. He is not on my team. He works for another radio station as far as I'm concerned.
Well, he works for the afternoon show.
Right.
That's what he does.
He works for somebody. I'm not sure what it is. I only wish I had the opportunity to wipe those guys off the face of the planet with a decent signal. I am deeply disturbed. In general.
I was going to say,
yeah, right.
Talking about now or in general? We know you're deeply disturbed.
I'm deeply, deeply disturbed by this. By this chain of events. I cannot get crucified by the FCC commercials on my own radio station. Which makes no sense. Because I know they're supposed to be running. I do not get to see TV commercials. And I am. My name is invoked by lowlives.
It's used in vain.
Yeah. I don't want my name mentioned by those guys. It's particularly painful to me.
Oh, now they're coming over here to start one of those great radio feuds.
Yeah, and I don't want a radio feud. I don't want this. I don't like the idea that I'm even talking about them. I don't like it. I do not want my name mentioned.
I don't need that. My career is a particularly painful one, where I have been fired and humiliated by program directors and general managers my entire career. The idea that other people make a living off of that is something that I've come to live with. I can bear it, but I certainly don't want to be made fun of for it. I don't want guys on my own station talking about how I should kiss their feet, even in jest. I don't need to hear it. I don't want my name mentioned by a jerk-off. After 11 a.m., I don't exist on WJFK. Do your own thing. Call your wife. Talk to your kid on the air and play dial-a-date, okay? The F word is slowly dripping out of my mouth, so I need to turn off my microphones now. It's just about to slip out. Pat it. Can you worry about just getting crucified by the FCC commercials on every hour? And worry about those two jerks talking about the king. Got it? I put up with general managers my whole career. I'm sick of all of them. Because all of you know nothing. Trust me. Because if any of you knew anything, you'd buy your own radio stations and do something about it. Don't call up anyone and start saying you don't want us running 1-800-52-STERN commercials. What am I doing here? Do me a favor. Get a job with the competition. Why you got to work with me for?
Goes back to that same old thing. They don't feel like they're running their station when you're on it, so they have to start doing things.
Yeah, they have
like
to
this.
Do things. They all think that they got to do something. The only thing you got to do is count the money. For Christ's sake. Pathetic. You start to believe they had something to do with Philadelphia and the ratings going up. They start to hallucinate, I guess. Ken, why not string me up and just hang me instead? You're killing me slowly.
Rip your skin off.
Rip my skin off. Yeah, boil me. Boil me. Eat my heart out like you're Jeffrey Dahmer. Eat my heart out. He's dead to me. I don't want a phone call from him ever. I will not answer it. Allowing promos like that to run. Understand your sense of radio history, for crying out loud. Kiss my feet, my daddy, I'm calling on the air, bah, 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 bah. I have this really neat bit planned where my daughter is going to interview John Stamos when he comes in. Now I'm sick of that. I don't even want to do it.
Yeah, well, you know that I was just thinking. Now, what do? You don't use your kids on the air.
Yeah, I don't use it. Right. I mean, it's just like every DJ doing what I do. It's just pathetic. At least I don't talk like a top 40 jock.
Hello.
Hello. Hey, daddy. Hey, honey. Good news. Hey, honey, good news.
What is it?
What, do these guys suddenly think I like them because they're working on our station? They start putting my name in promos? Brave guys, bucking management. Yeah, I know all about that. I know all about that. Okay, we got to take a break. Because my head's going to explode.
I'm sure we're long overdue for one.
Yeah, we are. Fred's been holding up a sign for 15 minutes. And Fred, you've been there with me the whole time.
Yeah. This guy's way out of line.
No kidding. Not running the spots. Not, you know, running a stupid promo. Just keep your ass shut. The promo should be, thank you, Howard, for allowing me to work. For giving me an idea of what I could do on the radio. For opening up my horizons. For making things good for me. Instead, I got to hear that crap. This little snide-ass remark from some five-year-old. Who wouldn't even have shoes on her feet if it wasn't for me. Let him sit her down tonight and read her the real story. How daddy don't have a creative ounce of... What I'm trying to say is he doesn't have a brain that could produce a creative thought.
Doesn't have a creative brain cell in his body.
Yeah, I heard what he was doing before I came along.
Hey, how you doing? Hey, everybody, WPGC.
We're going to be giving tickets to the 90-second caller.
Yeah. That was it. Yeah, that was the big bit. I got great tickets for you. John Cougar Mellencamp, baby. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Now I'm kissing his feet. That's what that's the history lesson his daughter's getting at home every night.
Well, you know he's going to lie to her.
It's like Mao Tse-tung sort of brainwashing the Chinese people, you know what I mean?
He's got a lot of hurt. Yeah. He's coming home, wants to be a hero.
Yeah, wants to be a hero. Daddy's home from earning a great living off of Howard's creativity.
Well, he should have started it all. He's older than you, isn't he?
Yeah. Yeah, you know? He is a lot older than me. Where was this guy his whole radio career? Bucking the system? I don't think so.
No, he's trying to hold on.
Yeah. Hey, you know, we could go on there and be outrageous and, you know, and get fired and stuff. And buck management. Oh, as long as they say it's okay. Not for me, his daughter be that Bangladesh kid on the album cover. Sitting with the flies around her head, waiting for next meal. Honey, I got bad news. The promo would be like this. Honey, I got bad news.
What is it?
Listen, we have to move to Iowa. Because I just got fired from my radio station. They just brought in a younger guy to, you know, talk the top 40 stuff. Is that the baby back there? Gee, I wish I could have a career like Howard Stern.
What will we eat tonight?
We're going to be eating Daddy's old socks. We're going to boil them in a hot soupy substance. Suck my
toe.
I'm so dangerously close to cursing, you wouldn't believe it. You just wouldn't believe it. We're going to have to eat the baby tonight, honey. It's us or him. Or her, whatever that was. We actually have to eat our own child, our own young. The placenta's awfully tasty. I feel like my skin looks younger from it.
But we can't even afford salt.
That's all right, but it's going to snow tonight, so what I'm going to do is collect the salt off the road.
Salt's bad for you, honey.
Yeah. Yeah, it retains water weight, and no one knows more about retaining water weight than me. I'm pretty much the guy who retains water weight for a living. Balls on these guys. The promos. Hey, you know, don't do me any favors. I don't own the station, so I can't tell you who to hire, and I don't care who you hire, but just don't have them talking about me with their babies. Hey, you know this baby tastes like chicken, honey. It's not so bad once you try it.
Oh, my God, you're kidding. I can't believe how poor we are. If only you could come up with a creative radio show.
Well, as soon as I hear Howard Stern, I'll have something to do. I'll call you on the air. We can have these discussions.
You wouldn't have to go to the bathroom, would you?
Why, are you thirsty? That's what they'd be doing if it wasn't for me. Quite frankly, that guy wouldn't be married if it wasn't for me.
That's right. Little girl wouldn't exist.
That's right. You had to have a little girl just to get her on the air. Just steal that bit.
Daddy.
Daddy. Daddy. You bring that kid to me, I'll teach that kid. I'll teach the kid real history, radio fact. Be living in a cardboard box. That'd be your dream house. Nice big, one of my refrigerator boxes. All these guys, Mark and Brian. All these guys. I know where it's at. You're going down. Screw all yous. All right, Robin, let's just take a break because we're falling behind.
All right.
All right. Go ahead.
94 WISP Philadelphia. Howard Stern all morning. Classic rock and roll all day.
He's not Robin's type. Mad Mike the Auctioneer sells every car to the highest bidder regardless of price. Save thousands of dollars from what you would pay to a dealer, used car, lot, or private seller. Pay the price you want to pay. Instant delivery and temporary plates are available. There's free admission, and at the end of every auction, they give away a free car.
Wow, so just hang in there.
Right, out-of-state buyers pay no sales tax. New Jersey Public Auto Auction is located at 75 Stockton Street in the Ironbound section of Newark, 3 miles north of Newark Airport. Take Route 1 and 9 north to Delancey Street or 1 and 9 south to Wilson Avenue. Remember, go to the auto auction every Saturday. Doors open for inspection at 10 a.m. and the auction starts at 12 noon. For more information, call 201-817-9500. That's 201-817-9500. New Jersey Public Auto Auction. You really get in on some good prices. on some cool cars. We got to let in Out of the Closet Stern and Mr. Blackswell.
What are they coming in for?
They're doing Whatever Happened to... Whatever Happened to Bernadette Stanis.
Who is Bernadette Stanis?
I don't know, Robin. How am I supposed to know? Out of the Closet Stern and Blackswell.
Now. I mean, these people are supposed to be people we care about. I don't know this person.
No, I think you do. You just don't know her name.
Oh,
she was on one of the old black TV shows. You know, Fred, what show was she on?
Good Times.
Good Times. She was the really good-looking black girl on Good Times.
Oh, she was JJ's sister?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh,
that was her name.
Bernadette Stanis, yeah. You feel like doing this? Okay, here we go, right? All right, I'll get into it.
You don't have to do it. Out of the Closet is.
Right, right, that's right. You know what? This will give me a breather because I get to leave the room.
Yeah. You go away. Get your head together.
Okay, I'll go away. I'm going to leave the room for a few minutes because I really need to get my head together because I feel betrayed. Oh, here they come. I'm leaving, Rob. You stay here.
All
then.
Right.
All right.
See ya.
All right.
Out of the Closet Stern.
Sue-wee.
Nothing has dimmed your spirits, have it?
Why is he so stupid?
Because what do you mean?
There's room for everybody.
Oh, dear. Oh, Mr. Love. Love them all.
Hey, just call me Patient Zero.
Very funny. Age jokes now.
Oh, please, we raise a lot of money for AIDS.
Do you?
Yes, we do, because, let me tell you something, Miss Quivers.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, by the way, this is my lover, Blackswell.
Hi, Blackswell.
Hi.
Blackswell, how you doing?
I'm doing wonderful.
We haven't been on the air in a while.
No, I think the station has a bias.
I think your voice has changed. Didn't you used to be a little more up-tempo?
Yes, I have. No, okay, there, now I'm feeling
okay,
better.
All right.
I was going to say, what made him so down?
Yeah, what's your problem?
I don't know, all this talk, it was just, I was on a bummer trip this morning listening to Howard.
We're kind of bummed out.
Yes.
Why?
Because, aren't morning shows supposed to be happy?
Yes.
Why is he always screaming?
Jolly.
You know...
You said you raised a lot of money for AIDS. How do you do that?
We have,
at the bus station.
Well, no. Don't make jokes. Have you ever seen, like, the muscular dystrophy telethon?
Yes.
Where they have people come on and have, like, bolathons.
And those long dances. What do they call those?
Marathon dance.
Yeah.
Yes. We do that for AIDS.
Uh-huh. You do?
Well, we have a butt-a-thon.
A butt-a-thon. Why am I talking about this? What is a butt-a-thon?
Well, that's not what I really came to talk about anyway. Not about our AIDS work.
Mm-mm.
Well, I would be interested in some charitable work on your behalf.
Well, in a way, we have a big announcement to make, if you'd like to hear that.
Really?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Okay, like Roseanne.
Yes.
Like Delta Burke. Like Oprah.
Oh.
I was molested as a young child.
Please, Out of the Closet. Is it called molestation when you're asking for it?
No, Joe. No, that's not funny. My father molested me as a young boy.
Really?
That's
right.
Serious.
You're serious.
So I want to say to Roseanne and Delta and Oprah.
Your sisters.
Join the club.
Yes.
It happens to men, too, is what you're saying.
And my father was so vile.
Well, what happened? How did this all go down?
Well, let me just say that I used to pray that my father was Michael Landon. Because if he was going to molest me, at least he had that marvelous head of hair.
Oh,
what a hunk.
Yes.
Told me not to make jokes.
And my father, it started, let me tell you when it started.
How old were you?
I was 9.
Uh-huh.
All right. And
what?
He waited that long?
What? It's very, very...
But he had the body of a 12-year-old.
It's just very upsetting.
Oh, that was a sob.
Yeah, I'm crying. I'm crying.
Okay. I thought you were laughing over there, because I'm still not believing
it. I'm so skeptical.
I was 9 years old.
Yes.
We were watching television, and I was sitting next to Papa.
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 You called him Papa.
Papa. Papa Uga.
Papa Uga.
Papa Uga.
Uga.
Your father wasn't...
What?
...gay, was he?
Well, he...
Happy.
I guess, in a way... He was gay. Please, Blackswell.
I'm sorry.
He's just like that Tom Arnold.
And yeah, in a way, he was gay in the sense that, I mean, he molested a boy.
Oh, but he was married to a woman, that whole thing.
Well, let me tell you what started out. It started out kind of innocent, okay? We're sitting there watching TV, and we're talking about the TV show and stuff.
What TV show were you watching?
Candid Camera.
Candid Camera.
Right. So, the old Candid Camera with Alan Funt.
Yeah, not the one that's on now.
No, I hate the one that's on now. It's terrible. So, we're sitting there watching TV, okay? And
he says to me, you should take your pants off. And I say, why?
In the middle of the TV show.
Right. In the middle of Candid Camera. Commercial comes on. He says, you should take your pants off. So I go like, why? He says, because I have these nuts.
Huh?
Walnuts.
Walnuts.
We used to keep a tray. My mom had a tray of walnuts.
Right. And
all right.
Taking your pants off have to do with that?
Well, there was no walnut cracker, so you should crack these walnuts in your buttocks. So I go, well, Dad, you know, isn't that kind of strange? Can't we just take a hammer?
Now, up until this point, were you kind of straight?
Yeah, I was very straight.
Hmm.
I like girls and everything.
Really?
Isn't that true, Blackswell?
Yes, disgustingly so.
Yes. So I said, Dad, you know, how am I going to crack these walnuts in my buttocks? And, so he says, try. Try. Right, Blackswell?
Yes, he did.
Right.
And he can still do it.
I can still do it.
Oh, no.
I mean, I squeezed my butt cheeks together for like an hour.
Would you like some nuts? Hold on.
Hold on. You want some nuts? Seriously, you want some nuts?
I don't want any nuts, but if you must demonstrate that for the sake of believability.
Give me one walnut. Just give me one, because it's early in the morning. Okay, here we go.
Oh.
Proof.
Oh, geez.
Proof positive. Excuse me.
Ooh. I really don't advise.
Ooh. Here, taste this.
No.
Eat this.
No.
Oh, big deal. Here, let me do another one for you. Is that amazing? I'll do two.
Oh, you really don't have to.
Ooh.
Ooh, excuse me.
That always happens too.
It's a lot of pressure in that area.
You try it.
No.
I always knew... Oh, excuse me.
Can't you stop now? It's all right. We don't want any walnuts.
But we're making brownies later. Excuse me.
It's like a Lay's potato chip.
Oops, I blew the nuts across the room. Blackswell, please, put away the nuts.
I'm sorry.
Oh,
even to this day, if Blackswell gives me nuts, I have to crack them because my father made me. And I always knew when my father was going to molest me.
Well, was that the extent of the molestation? You had to crack nuts?
No, it got much worse. And I always knew when my father was going to molest me.
How did you know that?
He put on a dress.
Oh.
Dang.
And this then, is why you hate women.
So then the next time it happened, I didn't think much about that. I felt a little strange when he had me cracking the nuts.
Yeah.
But the next time we were watching a TV show, and he says, you know, you should take your pants off and all that stuff. And my father says, you look sick. I say, I'm not sick. I'm fine. He says, no, you look sick. So I go, there's nothing wrong with me, Daddy. So he goes, no, I have to take your temperature rectally.
I thought he was Papa.
Right, Daddy, Papa, whatever. I had many different names for him. So my father takes my temperature with an indoor-outdoor thermometer.
Oh, no.
And I knew right then and there he didn't have my best interest at heart. I'm telling you.
So did you ever confront him and say, no, Daddy?
I didn't have the guts at that point
really?
To stand up to my father.
So when did this molestation stop?
Last week, I finally said to my father, Dad, I love Blackswell. I can't be with you. Mm. You know, that thermometer was round and it was a foot in diameter. And, you know, that's a lot for a young boy to handle. So, anyway, the point is that it's very bad to take advantage of people like that.
Children. Yes.
And that's why Blackswell and I...
Yes.
Are now counseling young people.
Oh, dear. Well, what's Blackswell's excuse? He wasn't molested, was he?
Blackswell, you were never molested, were you?
Every night by you.
Well.
But it's willing.
I love you.
You too.
Enough already.
God.
She can't handle it.
Everything is so violent these days with all of everyone molesting. Mm. And the 60s was so mellow compared to, yeah. You know, and there were no undesirables on the streets in the 60s.
What are you?
There was no such thing as the word yo back then.
Yo? That offends you.
Yo, yo, yo.
Yo.
Everybody's screaming, yo, yo, yo. Anyway, so, you know, this whole, a lot of gays want to join the Cub Scouts.
Yes, that's a big deal now. They don't have gay Cub Scouts.
Well, we are. We're
Scout Masters. They do.
Well, not acknowledged.
Blackwell and I are
Scoutmasters.
Scoutmasters.
You are?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, we take the children on
You trip. Have a troop?
Yes. Oh, yes, we sure do. There is a gay Cub Scout.
You mean the kids are gay, too?
Everyone is gay, because we don't care about the regular Cub Scouts. We're saying, hey, we're starting our own group.
You're the gay Scouts.
Of course.
There's the Boy Scouts, the Girl Scouts, and the gay Scouts.
Hmm. And I have a whistle and everything. But I don't even blow the whistle from my mouth.
Oh, dear.
I use another part of my anatomy. Want to see? Here, let me pull down my pants. Give me the whistle, Blackwell. Hold on a second. Hold on. Wait, what's the matter with you?
I went crazy.
You got to get rid of Blackwell.
Blackwell really is. You're always out to get me, you bitch. You've always been out to get me. You've been undermining me since the beginning of this segment. I can't take it.
That sounds like Fred.
I'm sorry.
All right. Really, it does. All right, let me just practice my whistle again for Robin. There you go.
It seems like an awful lot of trouble to go to get one little whistle.
And we go out on camping trip. We roast marshmallows.
Yeah, what do you do when you're out there?
Well,
you go on
it's different
out
than,
in the woods?
Well, it's different than the regular Cub Scouts.
Okay.
What I do is we tie the marshmallows to our private area. And Blackwell...
No one should be awarded for that.
Blackwell likes his marshmallows well done.
Yeah.
So you can imagine.
It's very touch and go.
Poor Blackwell was raised by Latvians.
Oh. Yeah, he comes by it naturally.
Anyway, Robin, let me take a short break. When we come back, you'll get to hear what happened to our special guest, Bernadette Stanis.
I wonder how we found her.
Oh, she's marvelous. She was very beautiful and young.
Yes.
And on, she was JJ's sister on Good Times.
Right.
Remember, whatever happened, like, where did that
Thelma,
pretty...
Thelma, wasn't her name?
Thelma. Where
something
did
like that?
Something like that, yeah.
Is it Thelma or Thelma?
No, Blackwell's name is Thelma.
Yeah.
Thelma was her name.
Was it Thelma?
No, Thelma.
Thelma.
Of course.
Thelma. Maybe.
Of course, Thelma.
I don't know.
And yeah. That was JJ's sister on the show Good Times. And she's very beautiful.
She just sort of disappeared after the show.
You never saw her in anything, and I thought it'd be fun to get her on the phone and ask her just what she's been up to.
Okay.
All right, so we'll be back right after these short words with Thelma.
All this weekend at 94WY, classic rock and roll all day.
You know what's the bad thing about it, right? We should put a couple of...
sexy scientist girls in there.
Yeah. At least show some breast. Yeah, sexy scientists. I like that. Topless. But anyway, there's an article on Earth 65 million years ago. 3/4 of the world's plant and animal species were wiped away in a mass extinction. Explore how it happened. Games. Conquering triskaidekaphobia, fear of the number 13. With a games column that shows how the number 13 can be more interesting than frightening. Because that's a real thing. People have fear of the number 13.
Sure.
An interview, moving corpses, computer-generated birds, rabbits, foxes, the evolution by computer of a complete biological cell. It's just, it's just kind of cool topics. The fall of Darwin, new research that, if accurate, may alter one of the most entrenched scientific theories of our time, the Darwin theory of evolution.
Oh, wow.
They're claiming that that these findings could offer a means of controlling our own cells, thus enabling us to control cancer and other illnesses.
Ooh, I better read that.
Yeah, it's a good magazine, created especially for Omni Magazine. Planet, the Omni Evolution board game. Each player controls evolution of his or her own planet. One, evolve a productive, I don't even know what this is about. Evolve a productive, non-polluting human, control temperature and atmospheric content, sabotage opponents' worlds with meteors, radiation, and pollutants.
Well, why would you want to do that?
It's a game. Could be Michael Landon didn't read this issue before. You know, maybe he would have.
He could have changed his cell.
Yeah. Omni, food for hungry minds. Get the October issue on sale now. I'm going to read this issue.
Yeah, that sounds very interesting.
And then when I learn something, I'll tell you about it.
No, I'll fight you for it.
Yeah. All right, here, you can have it. Jackie Penhouse, Joke Page Martling, by the way. Tonight, a big show, a night of Stump the Joke Man for the Rascals Comedy Hour in West Orange, New Jersey. For jokes and information, dial 516-922-WINE. Next Wednesday, October 2nd, at Bananas Comedy Club in the Fort Lee Holiday Inn in Fort Lee, New Jersey. All right, I got to leave, Robin. I haven't calmed down yet, so...
Yeah, you're supposed to be out taking a rest. I don't know why you ran back in for a commercial.
Here come those gay guys again. Out of the Closet Stern and his live-in lover, Blackwell.
All right.
His life mate.
Out of the Closet Stern, Sooey!
Sooey! We're back. We're actually back, aren't we? Blackwell, you better get it together.
I'm here.
What is wrong? Is Blackwell feeling okay?
I'm feeling fine.
It just doesn't sound like you.
There was a reverb on my voice. That's
okay.
Why.
All right. Well, is Bernadette around?
Bernadette. Bernadette, yes.
She had that little apostrophe in her
name.
Right,
I remember that.
Bernadette Stanis. Where's my Paul Lynde record, the soundtrack from Bye Bye Birdie? Do you have it?
I had it in my collection.
Oh, thank you.
I borrowed it.
You a Paul Lynde fan, Robin?
Not particularly.
Fabulous. Well, let me talk to Bernadette, then I'll play some of it for you.
We're remembering Paul Lynn today as well.
You hearing a ringing in your ears?
No.
Okay.
I think both of you are feeling under the weather.
Yeah, I think so.
Maybe we should crack some more nuts.
Oh, no.
I've lost it. Okay. Anyway, everyone remembers the great show Good Times. It's on all the time in reruns.
Do you remember the theme song?
Do I remember it?
It's in CD, too.
Yes, it is. It's in CD.
It's
on CD. We have
it. It's on CD.
Sure.
But you don't remember.
Good times.
Good times.
Good times.
Good times. Any time.
Anytime. Who could forget that? This is the best part.
Keeping your
head above water.
Making a way when you can.
Temporary layoff.
Good times. Easy credit ripoff.
Easy credit ripoff.
Scratching and surviving.
That song tells about the trials and tribulations of many of our black friends.
Yes.
Because.
Yeah.
A lot of times. There are temporary layoffs in the black community when blacks are struggling to come up the social and economic ladder. And what else, Blacksville?
What?
Go ahead.
What were you going to say?
I felt you're like not I even you paying off. Attention.
No, I am.
All right, let's talk to...
I was thinking of the easy credit ripoff.
Easy credit ripoffs. A lot of blacks can't get credit, so they get ripped off.
And they just take advantage of one another.
Because a lot of people who try to get credit, who are black, can't get it because of the color of their skin.
Right.
Yeah.
And then what happens is they go to unsavory characters for credit. Easy credit ripoffs.
Good times.
Good times.
Ain't we lucky we got them?
These are the good times.
These are the good times. And one of the stars of that show is on our phone. Hello? She hung up. She got good
heard
sense.
Heard that intro.
Good sense.
Oh, no.
What happened?
You waited too long.
What happened?
What? Well, she was on hold.
Yeah.
And she can hear the station.
Yeah.
And I thought you were going to go right to her.
Yeah.
And then you started talking about blacks hanging themselves over credit cards.
No.
We never said
no,
that.
Maybe she got disconnected. Call her back.
I will try, but...
All right, try her back.
What, is she a little...
She was there, I'm telling you.
You think she paid her phone bill?
Oh, she got ripped off.
By easy credit ripoffs.
Yes.
Because I have... We have a black friend in the gay community who borrowed $20, and he owes $950.
From you?
No, not from us. We're not unscrupulous businessmen. Hell, we're pretty honest, as a matter of fact.
So now he owes $950?
Yes. And that's only after borrowing for a week. So he's in a real fix.
It's a bitch.
Yeah. She's pretty upset. Oh, there she is. Okay, she got disconnected.
Gary, always overreacting.
Gary, overreacting.
He's nervous.
Hi, Thelma?
Hi.
Was it Thelma or Thelma?
Thelma.
Okay.
First of all, let me say how beautiful you were on that show.
Thank you.
Gorgeous.
You were always beautiful. Always looking good. And you were always very proud, I felt.
Thank you.
In other words, a lot of women have to straighten their hair and this kind of thing. You always had a natural afro. Right?
Yes.
And you were always so pretty. And it was everyone always used to joke in my household about how could JJ be this woman's brother?
I get it.
Well, you know what happened.
Mm-hmm. Well, if I liked women, you would have been for me.
Oh, well, thank you.
I can tell you that.
A Nubian goddess.
And you are so marvelous in that role. Very good actress. Now, where have you been? Why haven't we seen you in any of the films?
You know, I really don't know. I really don't know how that happened.
Who's your
or
agent?
Didn't happen.
Who is your agent? Because, do you have Mike Ovitz?
Do I have who?
Mike Ovitz.
No.
He is the most powerful agent
super.
In Hollywood.
Nice.
He's a super agent.
Well, I have to get his name from you guys and his number.
I'll give you his name and also a Mr. King Broder, who is a friend of ours, who we know, and very
worth off
the friend of the show. Very nice.
Hey,
name.
Okay.
Yes, and you've got to get right back into acting.
So you really did want to continue acting?
Well, yes. I never wanted to, you know, not continue.
Would you do nude scenes?
Absolutely not.
Really? Maybe that's what's holding you back.
What if the part required it and it was really good, you knew you'd win an Oscar?
What if it was Mr. Spike Lee who came to you and said, we have a part for you in the marvelous movie Jungle Fever 2, but you have to be topless. Would
you
do it?
No, that's
you
okay.
You would not do it?
No, I wouldn't.
Even for Spike Lee?
Who's Spike?
What if he said to you, I have a marvelous part for you in the new movie Malcolm X or X?
Well, I would love to be in that movie, but not nude.
I see.
Hmm.
Maybe I'll direct it or, you know.
I see.
Something like that.
See, that could be holding you back.
Yes.
What, the nude thing?
Yes, because a lot of guys would like to see you naked.
Oh, I'm sure.
Not us. Blackwell and I are more interested in acting.
Absolutely not.
Yes. Now, listen.
So what have you been doing since the show went off the air?
You know, J.J. Walker is a Malcolm X, and he's nude.
Yes.
He's agreed to work nude.
But nobody noticed.
On the set of Good Times, you never saw him nude, did you?
Oh, God, no.
I mean, you never walked around. Like, when you guys were in your dressing rooms and stuff, did J.J. Walker hit on you at all? Would he want to be your man?
No, you know, absolutely not. He's like a real big brother.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I hit him in the head and carry on. Yeah.
What about the young fellow, the younger brother? Would he be romantically attracted to you?
Oh, no, uh-uh.
What about John Amos? Did he ever try to do anything to you?
Absolutely not.
I wish he would have done something to me.
Have you been in touch with that lovely, lovely actress, Florida?
Esther Rolle. Yes.
Marvelous, marvelous.
Yes.
Was she friendly? Is she friendly?
She's wonderful.
She didn't cop an attitude.
No, no. She's a wonderful actress and a wonderful woman.
You know the last time you saw her, Blackwell?
When was that?
That was in the movie with...
Driving Miss Daisy.
Yes.
Driving Miss Daisy. Right. What a marvelous performance.
She did a nude scene in that, I think.
No. Yes, she did. She works nude. Do you know Shirley Hemphill?
Who?
Shirley Hemphill.
Mm-mm.
Nobody does. Don't feel bad.
Yeah,
don't feel bad. We feel better that you don't.
But what has Bernadette been doing since the show went up?
How do you fill your time?
Oh, okay. Well, I dance and I sing and, of course...
Where do you dance?
Well, I have been dancing like in classes and stuff like that and teaching classes.
Marvelous. That's so good
for your body.
Excuse me?
Freestyle dance?
Modern jazz.
Blackwell and I are in a modern jazz class ourselves.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, we are.
Oh, that's great.
Even.
We are so good at it.
We have a rendition of Stravinsky's Firebird you must see.
It's marvelous. Marvelous.
But once the teacher says go over to the bar, she loses it.
Right. We don't like the exercise bar. Want to see me tap dance? Here, Blackwell, a little music.
Okay.
If you would.
Oh my goodness gracious!
Excuse me. All right. Now.
Okay. And
Walkie, you dance.
Yes, and I'm studying directing, and I'm going to be directing soon.
Someone told me that you are a personal friend of a Mr. Bill Cosby who is teaching you how to direct. Is that true?
That is absolutely true.
Bill has a school?
No.
No.
He just has a show, a couple of hit shows, and.
I believe. Now, when do you get these lessons in directing?
When do I get them?
From Mr. Bill Cosby.
We go to the studio and we go through the procedure and from the beginning of the script, you know, the reading of it to cleaning it up and listening to listening to Bill direct it and whatever.
So Bill believes in you as a director.
Oh, definitely. He started me off.
That is marvelous.
So how did you meet Bill Cosby?
Yeah, how did you meet him?
I met Bill a long time ago in Los Angeles when we did Good Times. He was doing a show over at CBS. And I heard he was in the building because he was very big even back then.
Yeah.
And I went over and I met him, and he was lovely and great, and he had his little daughters with him.
So it's a strictly professional relationship.
Yes, it is.
All right, okay.
So there are other people on the set while he's teaching you.
Why doesn't Mr. Cosby fire that horrible Sinbad and hire you?
I don't,
and I'll tell you why, and it's very simple, and this is just my opinion. A black man should always keep his hair black, not red.
That's the color of his hair.
I don't care.
It's beautiful.
It's dyed black, right?
Doesn't look natural to me.
Really?
That's Lucy's hair.
That's Lucy's hair. Everyone loves Lucy.
Yes.
Yes. And now,
did Bill ever do his Groucho impression for you?
Yeah. Well,
marvelous. Marvelous.
Yes. He's going to be doing a show.
Bill doesn't have red hair.
No, but
someone told me Sinbad's pubic hair is green.
Oh,
we don't know about that.
I don't know anything about that. I don't want to touch that with a 10-foot pole.
Maybe an 11.
You betcha. Well, so this is exciting that you're directing, and I bet you got a lot of residual money from Good Times, so you can live pretty much high on the hog.
Well, I don't know. I never lived high on the hog, you know.
Don't be modest.
No, I didn't. I never did.
Could I ask you a question?
Did you save up a lot of money from that show?
Yes, I did.
So you can pick and choose your projects, like so many big stars.
Well, you know, I wish there were more projects for women. especially for black women.
Here,
you know,
here.
I
here, here.
Wish there were more positive projects that we could choose from, you know?
Because there's just a lot of blaxploitation films.
Yes.
Because, what was that film I saw, Robin?
What film?
Sweet, Sweet Badass
Sweet,
Song.
Sweet, Sweet Badass Song.
What? No, Sweet, Sweet Back.
Oh, that Sweet, was Sweet ancient. Yeah. That's yeah. a long time ago.
That's the last black film you saw?
Yeah. Now, where are the good roles for black women? You don't see it anymore. Well, even that Spike Lee had them all naked and running around.
Yeah, well, I don't understand that. I just wish that maybe we could put our clothes on and act like humans, you know?
Here, here. Here, here. We're with you. You're our sister, if you will.
Oh, right, brother.
Did, now, you are so good-looking. Did you ever get married?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I got married.
Ooh, what a lucky man.
Thank you.
What did
and
he
I
do?
Have, I have a daughter.
Oh, congratulate. That didn't ruin your fabulous figure, did it?
Oh, no. I'm so glad.
And in other words, your stomach is very flat and hard, right?
Yes. And no stretch marks.
And wow. That didn't make your breasts get saggy.
Oh, my goodness gracious. How graphic.
Out of the closet.
Well, I'm sorry, but a lot of women do want to know, and I want to know. Blackwell wants me to have a baby, and I'm afraid of my breasts getting saggy.
I was going
to
say, he's envious of you.
Blackwell breastfeeds every night.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yes.
They become I keep waiting.
You know, my mother, God bless her, I loved her, and she's not alive anymore. And she, we set her up in a condo in Florida. You wonder what killed her? The day I told her I was living with Blackwell.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness.
But I will tell you something. My poor mother, she had 9 children.
Yeah.
Her breasts became cucumbers.
Oh.
Ooh.
Literally from 9
yeah.
children. And you know that can happen, Bernadette.
No, it can't happen. No, no, no.
Now, I remember on the show you had an apostrophe in your name.
Burn, no, I didn't. I just had a space. I had, like, I separated my
burn,
name.
Burn, debt.
No, burn, nay, debt.
Burn, nay, debt.
And that you know, debt. I wrote that, like, when I was, like, in the 7th and 8th grade. You know how you do
right.
doodle in class?
Yes.
Well, okay, I said, if I ever made it, this is how I'm going to spell my name.
Exactly.
And that's exactly what I did.
And you still call yourself Burn, nay, debt.
Well, I say Bernadette, but you know.
Yeah. Mm. Hey, you know who does that? Jack Hay. Jack Hay.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
But I think I started it.
I think you did, too. What about that other woman, Janae?
Oh, she
Janae.
Changed it in the middle, too. Yeah,
yeah.
She changed
yeah.
her name.
Yeah, she did. Yeah.
Her name is Janet.
I know that the guy who hosts this show, Howard Stern, has changed his name.
It's Howard.
Yeah, oh, did he?
Yeah. Now, let me ask you
who
something.
Got paid more, by the way, in the, of the Norman Lear shows? Was it yours or All in the Family?
I bet you it was the white All in the
I'll
Family.
I'll bet you.
I do not know. We don't know anyone's salary.
Do you remember? I bet you J.J. Walker got more money than you, and that's, again, a man over a woman.
I bet.
Hey, I remember when Janet Jackson was on your show.
Yes. Oh, yes.
You must be very happy for her success.
Yes, I am. She's a lovely person.
Does she
very
call?
She is a very, very sweet person.
Is she in touch with you? Are you directing her videos?
No, not yet.
But I bet you will.
If I ask her, I'm sure I will.
I mean, you are
you
old
should.
Friends.
You should.
Yeah, we're friends.
And women, sisters should help sisters.
Well, you know, that's absolutely
that
correct.
That is the only way black women will get ahead. If sisters help other sisters.
I know.
Black soul, am I right?
Sisters are doing it for themselves and each other.
Yes.
Wait a minute here.
Did you ever date Mike Tyson?
No, I know. I know Mike.
Did he ever grab your buttocks?
He better not.
You damn right.
No, he wouldn't do anything like
you
that. You know, he's very respectable. I don't understand what's going on.
Blackwell grabs my buttocks.
Yes. Did you ever have jungle fever?
Did you ever have jungle fever? That's a good question.
Well.
You did, didn't
she
you?
Did.
Husband,
we all have.
Is your husband jungle fever?
No.
Oh, you married a black man.
He's a jungle. No.
He's a jungle. Not a jungle fever.
What did you marry?
You know, that's so good to hear that you you married a black man.
I'll oh, yeah? Why?
Because it's so nice. Because
well, blacks, well, and Mr.
Well, look
out
at
of
Gregory,
the Closet's turn
yeah.
constantly say that once blacks make it,
yes.
they go off
Diana
and marry
Ross.
White.
Diana Ross.
Well,
Diana
that's
Ross
not
prime
true
example.
Because there are a lot of people that marry whites who never will make it or never did make it. Or
yes, that's
you know.
True. That is true.
So,
but
I mean,
but
got,
there seems to be
the,
a higher proportion.
You know what it means. It gives a lot of pride back to the black community to know that you married,
right.
you know, someone in the community.
Well, he's not exactly in the community.
What is he?
What is he? Is he Chinese?
I guess he's in some community. He's not in my community.
We don't know what community he's in.
Oh,
where's
well,
he
he's
from?
He's from Ohio. He's an accountant. And, you know, one of those safe type of people.
I understand.
Yeah,
that's smart.
Me.
Because
so he's invested your money wisely.
Yes.
Oh, that's marvelous. And let me tell you something. That is so. I'm so proud to hear that.
Thank you.
Because you know, to marry someone in show business is a curse.
I know.
You know what I'm
saying? I believe that.
Yes. Well, let me say, this is so exciting. You have money, you have a lot of money because your husband invested it,
yes.
and you still get residual money from good times. right? Am I correct in saying
that? You're correct.
And you're living a marvelous life here in New York, I understand.
Well, yes.
Yes, you're so lucky.
I didn't know you were in New York.
You are so very lucky. You know, accountants are very horny.
You know, is that what that is?
Yes, that is. Oh, he must, and you are so lovely that he must go even hornier than the regular account.
Does he brag?
Does he brag to his friends that he has you?
Oh, no, he doesn't play that.
I used to guess at your measurements. If I was a woman, I'd want a body just like yours. I am
going
to guess.
Thank you.
38C?
No way.
38D?
No way.
Really?
C.
Oh, you want me to tell you?
Yes.
34B.
Get out of here.
Did
go back
stop?
To school.
Did you
wear a padded bra on the show Good Times?
No, it's all there.
Because your mother, Esther Rowe, is a very full-figured woman.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, TV makes everything look bigger. I always say that to Blackwell.
Well,
B's look like C's.
Huh?
B's look like C's on TV.
Yeah, I know.
How tall are you?
I'm 5'5".
I thought you were much taller.
Yes, she looked taller. She was such a slight thing.
Yes. You know, I heard in real life...
I wore big shoes.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
I heard in real life Oprah looks normal. But on TV, they put weights on her. I'm not kidding. I'm so proud of you. Congratulations on the birth of your child.
Birth of my child? She's an old woman now.
How old is she?
She's 9.
9. Oh. Congratulations on the birth of your child 9 years ago.
No brothers and
Thank
sisters?
Thank you.
And are we going to have any little brothers and sisters?
Maybe one day.
That would be marvelous.
It better
don't,
be soon,
Don't
huh?
wait too long.
Don't wait too long, because what happens is your eggs will petrify.
Right. Oh, my God.
And then you won't be able to have, then the sperm.
Now I'll have an old, real old kid or something.
You'll give birth to a stone baby.
A stone baby.
Oh, Lord.
And we are so... very happy to hear that things are going well for you.
Yes, thank you. And I'm going to be producing a show, a comedy, on a 47th Street Theater called Willie and Esther November.
Willie and Esther, what is that about?
Oh, it's a comedy. It's about a guy who's getting ready to rob a bank.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
Yeah, it's real funny.
Will J.J. Walker be the man who's going
to
rob the bank?
I tried to get him.
You would not do it? And the man will rob the bank, and then what happens? He goes
he
to jail?
He doesn't rob the bank. And these two characters end up talking each other out of it.
Oh, marvelous.
I mean, maybe we could play that.
Can we have a small role in it?
Sure you can.
Thank you. You really must call Michael Ovitz as an agent. He'd be marvelous for you.
Okay.
All right, and think about taking that top off for the next film you're in.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
Oh, please, Robin. You don't know show business.
The biggest stars have done it.
You know, but I can't do it. That's like you said, that must be my problem.
Suzanne Summers posed nude.
Yeah. She did?
Oh, yes. She was in Playboy Naked.
Really?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Early in her career, she was nude.
Oh, my goodness.
And
Kim Basinger.
Jessica Hahn was naked.
Yeah.
And she's now in a movie with Morton Downey Jr.
You don't aspire to that, do you?
You know, you could be in that movie.
I want to be in that movie.
Yeah.
We could make a phone call.
Yes. So you have to think about taking your top off. Don't be so shy.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes.
Oh, I am very shy.
And Susan Sarandon has gorgeous cams.
The best.
So they put her in a movie so they could see it, huh?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Now, listen. You think it over and give me a call back. And listen, good luck with everything.
Thank you.
All right. The very lovely Bern Ladette Stennis. Mm. And she, of course, will not pose nude. She was in Good Times and now has a play coming out.
Yes.
Yeah. Very cool. You know what, posing nude. You know, years ago, Playboy approached me to pose nude.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember that.
Think about it. It's so beautiful. It's a living memento.
Never. Never.
How much money did they offer you? I'm curious.
Oh, it was pretty big back then.
Substantial?
Yeah.
$50,000?
No, not quite that much.
Mm. Oh. No wonder.
Yeah, right?
You want some career advice?
Yeah.
Avoid Mickey Rourke. Because they'll have you stripped down and naked in 2 seconds.
And nobody will still see your movie.
That's right.
Well, that's probably the best way to do it if you don't want anybody to see you.
And we look forward to seeing the play that you're doing.
Oh, yes, yes.
What's the name of it again?
Willie and Esther.
Willie and Esther. And that's where?
At the 47th Street Theater. And tickets, you can buy tickets at the Ticketmaster starting next week.
Blackswell and
Is
I
Is that
love...
a Neil Simon play?
No, that's not Neil Simon play.
No?
No, it's by James Bronson.
James Bronson, I believe that's a black playwright.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's very good.
It's like a funny play. It was in L.A., and then now we're taking it, you know, we're bringing it here.
And Blackwell and I love theater. We love dressing for theater, and we love to enjoy theater.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bernadette Stennis, everyone. Marvelous to talk to you.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Isn't she lovely? Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
All right.
That's a very lovely girl.
Yes,
sweet.
Very pleasant.
Come on.
Put up with all of your wacky proposals.
Give me a walnut. I'm hungry.
What?
My buttocks.
Mm.
It's hard to crack walnuts with your buttocks. Try it, Robin. Here.
No.
Come on.
No,
don't be such a prude.
I will not do it.
Blacks,
I'll
get a tissue, will you?
And what do you do with these walnuts now?
We're going to make fudge brownies later.
A mess. Don't ever invite me over.
Sweetheart, do you have a tissue?
Yes, I do.
All right, thank you.
Sweetheart.
We're going to be making a coconut souffle later, so stick around.
I didn't get a chance to play my Paul Lynn music.
Well, it's
I'll leave the record with you.
Oh, yes, thank you.
Yeah. P.U., light a match. Okay. Bye, everyone. So long.
Goes.
Put us back in the closet, please. What the hell was that?
I don't know. Out of the closet, sir. Where's your music?
You. No music. Just close the door correctly.
Oh, I guess you can't leave.
Idiot.
Can't get rid of you today.
All right, just play a commercial then, will you?
So what did you decide, Robin? Karen Carpenter's story? Or...
Well, we had the return to... Mayberry.
Return to Mayberry. Return to Mayberry is good.
Very good.
All right, why don't we do that here?
I Shot Lucy is excellent.
All right. I choked Lucy. This is just to impress Los Angeles, to show off a little bit.
All right, what do we blame?
All right, why don't I play Return to Mayberry?
Okay.
I think, because that's a good one. The original Return to Mayberry. We had two of them.
Yes, I thought we did.
Here we go. This needs no setup, does it?
No, everybody knows what the Andy Griffith Show was all about.
Yeah, this is sort of our theory on what should have happened. A couple of years ago, they did a Return to Mayberry. It was kind of disappointing. And we felt this is what should have happened to the characters, but scene we'd like to see.
Return to Mayberry, 25 years later. Starring Andy Taylor, Barney Fife, Ed B., Opie, and Floyd the Barber.
Aunt Lee, whatever you do, don't open the door for nobody.
Yes, Andy.
With that biker gang terrorizing Mayberry, you better be careful.
Yes, Andy.
Aunt Lee, Mayberry has changed a lot in 25 years.
Yes, Andy. Who ever thought things would get like this?
Imagine my girlfriend, Helen Crump, dying of a fatal muscular disease.
Andy.
And poor Howard Sprague getting caught with that young boy up in Mount Pilot.
Heavens, they do move fast up there.
They sure do, Empty.
And poor Goober.
Old Goober.
Oh.
Vietnam. Damn, that bomb did him in.
Oh, atomic bomb?
No, hee-haw. Bad career move.
Oh. Hi, Ange.
Oh, hi, Barney.
Hi, Barney.
Come on, Ange. Business in town. The biker gang's on
the loose. The biker gang.
Okay, Barney, calm down. Aunt B, don't you forget to lock the door.
Yes, I did.
Hey, whoever thought that me, Floyd the Barber, would become the largest cocaine dealer in North Carolina?
Ooh. Hey, Floyd.
Hey, hi, Barney. Andy.
Hey, Floyd, you got any more of that new stuff in the bag?
Ooh, I know. Crack.
Yeah, that's it.
Barney, don't you think you're hyper enough?
No. It's for old Ange here.
Andy, crack for you?
Well, I'm pretty down, Floyd.
Ooh, what's wrong, Andy?
Well, it's my son. Oh. He's turned into such a low life.
You mean Ope?
Well, he don't call himself Ope no more. It's the Cope.
Ooh, you mean that loser DJ in New York? That's really Opie.
Yeah, he calls himself Cope. I can't believe it.
Ooh, Andy, you need cocaine.
Well, thanks, Floyd.
Yeah. Hey, get your belt. I'll go in the back and get the worms.
You know, Barney, I think you better call Aunt B and make sure she's all right.
Okay, Andy. I hope nothing terrible happened to her, though. Aunt B! Aunt B! Aunt B, what's going on?
Right. One hell's angel after another, forcing me to act out double penetration.
Double penetration? Aunt B! How many bikers are there?
I've been violated 65 times thus far.
Oh, my God, that's terrible, Aunt B.
Oh, I was hoping for at least 75 times.
Oh, my God, Aunt B! Aunt B, speak to me!
Bring me another rugged stud biker.
Aunt B!
Oh,
later.
Ooh, Andy, what's that? Aunt B being raped?
No, the fact we're snorting all this cocaine and not freebasing it. So good.
No problem. Here, here, light this. Ooh.
All right, now.
Now hold this match and blow.
Okay, I'll be blow right through here, right?
Right there.
Wait, Ann! I don't think you're supposed to be blowing on that!
No, no!
Ann,
no! No! No!
There's always a morality lesson, like to the evils of drugs, you know, because there they were, and Ange didn't know how to handle freebasing and then blew himself up. See? That's the best part of it. It was always, you know, and everyone was always polite in Mayberry, even, you know, in the midst of all that turmoil. Fabulous. Return to Mayberry. Blast from our past, Robin.
Yeah.
If you will. Everybody loves. Return to Mayberry. 852-923-KROQ-WYSBWJFK. We've got to take a short break and then do some news. And when we come back, what's the big story, Robin?
What is the big story?
What is it?
Think?
What will be the lead story?
Gee, there's just a lot of little things I wanted to talk to you about.
Good. That's what I like the best. I like the newscast where the little things. I don't like one big story.
One big story?
No, seriously. I like when you do a little TV news, a little film news. A little, you know what I'm saying? A little light stuff, a little heavy stuff, racial stuff. You know what I'm saying? You go around.
Yeah, we're just going to talk about the human condition.
Yes. I like that.
Oh, Andy!
But they are holding hostages over in Baghdad. You know that, don't you?
Well, you got one guy to blame for that. That's President Bush of ours. Had the chance to knock off Saddam Hussein. Had a chance to go in there and knock off their whole, all their rulers, if you will.
Get rid of that whole regime.
Could have gotten rid of everything. Could have cleaned up the whole nuclear problem over there. We could have gone right in, figured out where all the nuclear weapons are. Could have taken our sweet-ass time about getting out of there. You know, listen, even Schwarzkopf said it. You got it. When you go in there, you're fighting a war. Who do we end up killing? We ended up killing these people. These schmoes don't even know what's going on.
Innocent people.
So it's no problem killing innocent people as long as we can get to that Saddam Hussein. So what do? We choke and we don't get him. So now we're in the same stupid position. But I'm no brain surgeon. Everybody was saying you got to go in and get Saddam Hussein, take him out on a war crimes thing, and take him to the back and kill him.
Why did we stop?
Because we're... don't say we.
What?
Our leader told us to stop.
But why did he do that? What was the rationale?
I do not know that. All right, we'll be back right after these words.
Tonight, the...
Howard Stern all morning. Classic rock and roll all day.
So anyway... So then, I said to Gary, why don't you call them and make sure that... Because, first of all, it's just a hassle for me to bring it back now. So Gary speaks to the guy yesterday, and he says what?
Well, I thought that after you did that thing on the air yesterday,
right,
that he would, I felt, not that you did, but I thought that he'd say, well, you know what, just to Howard to keep, we'll get another one over there.
Right.
So he called me. I didn't have a chance to call him back, and he said, hey, I heard what you guys did on the air today. It was very funny.
Right.
I said, oh, thanks. He said, okay, so, tell Howard to bring the machine in. and then he said, my favorite part was, he goes, gee, it's all hooked up already. I hope it's not damaged.
Right. Hey, it is damaged, by the way. It's going to look pretty big because it has a big dent in it. Like I broke off a piece of the molding.
Are you serious?
Yeah. I'm very serious.
Well, you're going to have to explain to people they don't come like that.
Yeah, well, I guess. I kicked it last night. It's really a cool fax machine. It's got tons of features on it, including anti-curl system. Brother Fax 400 series. You got to ask for it at Staples, J&R Music World, and Allied Office Supplies. But didn't the guy say that he thought it was the best commercial he heard? Because it was a great commercial. It was a great bit.
But it wasn't a commercial. It was a bit.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I was just talking.
Right. He said he thought it was very funny. Now could you bring the machine back?
Yeah. Would you got his kinda... commercial, now bring the machine.
Would you really want the guy who does your live advertising, though, to... sort of feel like he was given something and then it was taken
and
back.
He was ripped. It was ripped from him.
I mean, is it really worth that? No, I mean, seriously. I mean, if you were, wouldn't you be smart and say, hey, okay, maybe there was a misunderstanding, but hey, the guy brought it home and he's using it and he's talking it up like there's no tomorrow.
I think I'll leave it there.
Yeah, why not leave it there? Hey, Brother's a big company. I think it's a billion or $2 billion company.
It's a multi-million dollar company.
Yeah, it's billion. You can safely say billion. Yeah.
It's not clear. Was Gary talking to the guy from the agency?
The ad agency. Yeah, the ad agency.
I think you should just hear Lonnie's voice in his head and just sort of, you know, let it go.
That's a pretty obscure reference, Jeez. Gary. I love having you in here, but until
but
you screw
Robin
up.
Robin brings that up all the time.
No.
Yes, it... she brings that up all the time.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, yeah, right.
Good job. He always blows it with me. He's doing so good, too.
Don't try to be me, Gary.
To blow it with you, all you have to do is stick around more than long enough, because eventually someone will blow it. I'll just stick around here long enough, and I'll keep talking, and then suddenly I'll be out of favor.
All right, thank you.
Like everyone.
FMEs, Gary, FMEs. Yeah. Think about it.
Write them and I'll pull them.
September, why don't you pull them?
You got to write them. I never pull them. You write them.
No. You go to the computer. Do I have to tell you how to do your job? Every year, you go to the computer first. Come here. You know why he walks away when I'm right?
Yeah.
You can't take it. Don't tell me how we do
it. That's how it goes. Every year, we sit down and you say, we want to do some FMEs. Okay. You guys sit there and we brainstorm and I come in and I can help you guys
Here's
out
how it goes.
Going over some stuff.
I say it's time to do the FMEs, our award show.
Write me some categories and I'll pull them for you.
And I say, why don't you look through the computer, find some stellar performances. And what's wrong with you taking the initiative? Every September, I want to
Because I'm not a writer.
No, you don't have to be a writer.
You're a great listener, though.
Right.
You know, every September, we do the FMEs.
Right.
So take the initiative. Go look through the computer and see if you can find some, like, really cool bits that might be applicable and we can write around it. You would save me some time.
Okay, but...
You would rather me go and make up categories from memory?
You know, and he always gets upset with us when we do that because then he can't necessarily find everything.
You're right, I know.
But give me a nucleus to start with.
Why don't you give me a nucleus to start with? This year we're going to do it differently, okay? Since you don't think that's the way we do it. Do it different.
Okay. Yeah.
Go make me a nucleus. All right. And go reinvent the atom. Nucleus. I'll give me a nucleus. Nucleus. Got the nucleus to start with. Brother Fax 400.
Gotta give it back.
So good, we hate to give it back.
Oh, well.
So you said you had a variety of topics.
That's right, Howard. First of all... The Iraqis, who are supposed to be letting some United Nations personnel root around plants over there and determine what they're doing in terms of developing nuclear weapons and so forth, well, for the past couple of days, they've been holding one of these UN fact-finding teams in a parking lot. They've surrounded them with military equipment. And soldiers, and they will not let these people go because they apparently took documents that show exactly how far along they were with creating a nuclear weapon.
Isn't the United Nations a stupid organization? Imagine this. Look how stupid they are. They go into a hostile country. It's still openly hostile. Saddam Hussein is still in power. So they go there, and what do? They give them the best weapon in the world. They let them hold hostages. We just delivered them 40-some-odd hostages. We're idiots. But this Hussein seems to be a bigger idiot. He releases them, and then we go in and bomb them. You know, if he had held those hostages originally, Hussein, remember he had hostages?
Right, he held those Americans on the plane.
He never would have been attacked, ever. Hussein.
Really, you think?
Oh, absolutely. He never would have been bombed, and none of that.
Well, maybe he's learned his lesson, and this time he's not letting these
people. He won't let these UN. If he's smart, he won't let these UN people go.
Well, you know, he did send a letter to someone, so they're negotiating about the release of these people.
Great, now we're negotiating with them.
Yeah.
Before we had him in a position, we didn't have to negotiate anything. Hey, here's what we want.
Now,
we were there.
Conditions.
We were there. We blew away his army. We should march right in there again now and finally do what we were supposed to do. Kill this guy. Just kill him like we killed all his people.
Meanwhile, the people who are being held, they sort of have baffled the guards who are watching them because, you know, they're out there playing touch football and, you know, putting on the brave face.
Right.
Having a good time, acting like, you know, nobody's holding them hostage. They decided to camp out in this parking lot.
Right.
But they do say they're getting a little funky right now. They haven't had a bath in a few days.
Right.
And, you know, nobody'd want them over for dinner at this point in time because it's kind of rank.
Especially after a few good games of football, you know. You get kind of cheesy.
So they were going to hold a wash your compatriot.
A lot of nice bonding going on
today.
How many women?
Listen to these boys.
How many women and how many men are?
I don't think there are any women in this group.
It was a horrible situation. 20 men and 20 women. We had to bathe each other. We were forced into each other's arms.
They said they're going to wash each other, scrub your buddy in his clothes day or something. So they're going to get buckets of water and try to wash each other down.
While they're wearing their clothes.
They smell, yeah.
Well, they shouldn't have been over there in the first place. That's number one. You could go on a fact-finding mission.
Also in the news, British guy they let go the other day. Jack Mann, I think his name is.
Did you see him at the airport with his wife?
Yes.
And she had on the giant glasses?
She had, and they were a bright blue.
Yeah.
See, I didn't get the color experience.
I'd hop right back on the plane.
Did you? I mean, really?
They said he was babbling, and now I know why.
He looked at her and just started.
Darling.
Take me back. He wants to be a captive again.
Darling, you make Swifty Lazar look normal.
So anyway, yes, the wife thanked everyone for all their help. Behind the glasses are bigger than she is.
Oh, yeah.
It's a wonder she can keep them up on her nose. In Pakistan, doing a world roundup.
Go ahead, don't stop.
Two American converts to Islam.
Yes, Cat Stevens.
Sentenced yesterday to amputation of their right hands and left feet for robbing a bank.
Wow.
Apparently they converted to Islam, but they kept some of their American way.
Yeah. So where was this?
In Pakistan.
Right.
You know, that's a very heavy-duty Muslim country.
Right.
And they go by the law as stated in the Quran. And the Quran says you cut off hands and feet of robbers.
You cut off both hands and both feet?
No, just the right hand and
the
left foot.
The offending hand and foot.
What is the left foot?
I don't know. That's a gay foot. Wow.
Yeah, so now they're trying to appeal. They robbed this bank of 80,000 rupees. Which is about $3,200.
I bet you there's very few robberies in those countries. And, you know, those two guys are too schmucks. You know what we'll do? We'll convert to Islam, go over there, and you know what? There's such roofs over there.
Yeah, they'll be pushovers.
And nobody, everyone's too stupid to even rob there. We'll just go right through. Now, all of a sudden, they're facing their hands and their foot cut off. Let me tell you something. Yeah. That's what they should be doing in this country. Every one of those little creeps in Crown Heights who went looting and stole TVs, round them up and cut off their feet. Ah, boy, would that be the day, huh? Little criminals.
Well, the boys claimed the bank manager had refused to let them withdraw the amount from their accounts, so they just took it, I guess. But, hey, they were in the wrong place to do that.
Crooks. Oh, do I love
that. So now they're going to try to appeal, but they're looking at losing limbs.
Imagine what they do for rape over there.
Oh, my goodness. And on top of that, see, I think the best part is that it also includes jail time.
Yeah.
And fines. You know, after they cut off your hands and your feet, they aren't finished.
Good.
You go to jail then for a few years, and then you have to also pay them, you know, or work off some money that you owe them.
It's like those Central Park, the jogging case. Those little animals they caught in the park, right? Those little heathens. The best punishment would have been to make those parents of theirs pay for the rest of their lives to this woman now who's all befuddled because of this attempted rape. Would that have been the greatest?
Absolutely.
I guarantee you, you wouldn't see any more of these ghetto youths running around all confused. My parents weren't here. This and that. You would see there'd be drastic reduction in illegitimate children. Because if you knew your child could grow up, commit a crime, and then you had to pay for that crime for the rest of your life, you would see suddenly there'd be responsible birth control. Make me your senator. Make me your president. Do I have the answer or what? All those little creeps that looted, that took the TVs, round them up. Cut off their hands and feet and make their parents pay for the rest of their lives for those television sets. Put them on the good layaway plan with interest.
Well, anyway, these guys, and then, you know, what the Pakistani government plans to do after they finish their sentences.
Yeah.
You know, they put them in jail, they cut off their hands and feet, they get the fines.
What do they do with the hands and feet, Robin?
I don't know what that is. Throw them at them. No.
They beat them with them.
They cut off your foot and throw it at you.
Put it in your mouth so you can't breathe.
No, they're going to send them back to the United States after that. They don't even want them in the country after they finish serving their time. Yeah,
oh,
but
great.
It's on appeal. They'll have to see.
They should
they can beat the rap.
They should take the hands and feet and feed them to the people they robbed. What do you think of that? Sit there and eat it. Tastes like pork chops.
Here in the United States, Kimberly Bergalis has made her way to Washington. She's the young woman who developed AIDS because she was exposed to the virus by her dentist.
By some idiot healthcare professional.
That's right.
Despicable. Did
I
you
don't
see
know
her?
He was an idiot.
Did you see her on Oprah?
Yes, I did.
I'll tell you one thing, boy. That AIDS is this girl is not going to be a centerfold in Playboy. I'll tell you that. Boy, what that did to her body. Yeah. And these creeps who work in the hospitals who keep it concealed that they've got the AIDS, you know, because they think that they shouldn't have to come forward. You know what amazes me? When you go to a hospital and a guy is afraid of you, you've got some sores on you or something, he can take precautions. He can put on a spacesuit, gloves, right, whatever he wants. When I go to the dentist puts on gloves, he's got a mask, he's got an iron wall.
Right.
Guess a lot of them figure that I've been up to some weird stuff. But I'm going to tell you something. I don't blame them for doing that.
I thank them.
But
because I think they're protecting themselves and me.
Right. And let me tell you something. The idea that you got, there was one woman I saw on TV yesterday. She had a baby. The doctor, the gynecologist had the AIDS. He had open sores on his hands. Oh. And, you know, what is with these guys?
But, you know, we are passing all these laws in various parts of the country that sexual partners, it's mandatory that sexual partners inform each other,
right,
about the AIDS virus. And that may be against the law if you don't. Well, I don't see what the difference is. If a sex partner has to do it, why wouldn't your doctor if he's going to do an invasive procedure on you? It's the same deal.
Never mind invasive. My doctor's going to breathe on me. I want to know about it.
So anyway, she has now made her way. She got on a train.
Yeah.
For a couple of days. The poor sick child. And made it to Washington. I understand. You know, at one point we were talking about how close she was to death.
Yeah, right.
And she came out of a coma to go testify in Washington.
Hear that, Fred? She came out of a coma to testify. How about you coming out of your coma? Writing a few jokes.
But anyway, she's going to be testifying before Congress today. They didn't expect a very warm reception because they, you know, her parents and she feel that nobody wants to hear what she has to say.
That's great. Whole life ruined. Go ahead.
Dr. Zeus.
I used to go to him. 87
years old.
He did a... He did a DNC on me.
No, stop it. Dr. Zeus did not do any DNC on you.
He told me he was a real doctor. I was alone. I was lonely.
You didn't have anything to do with DNC in.
You call him Dr. Zeus. I believe it. Would you?
Zeus. All right.
Well, I'm just saying. Maybe I was wrong. I don't know. Dr. Zeus is the guy on Mount Olympus.
No, that is Zeus. Dr. Zeus, 87 years old. He's dead after a long illness.
Dr. Zeus.
Yes.
I hate that Dr. Seuss.
Oh, stop it.
I really hate all those books.
I love those books.
I said to my wife, do we ever read the kids' Dr. Seuss? She goes, yeah, the kids like some of them. I go, what do they mean? I don't even get it.
You didn't understand The Cat in the Hat.
No. Uh-uh. I don't.
Green Eggs and Ham has you baffled.
Yep. Cat in the Hat. I don't even get that.
The Grinch That Stole Christmas. You couldn't understand that.
Not only did I understand the book, I saw the movie.
You couldn't understand the movie.
I didn't understand that. A cartoon movie.
You're terrible.
I swear.
Theodore Geisel.
I didn't think, you know, any idiot can write a children's book, and that is the truth. And if you don't believe me, I could write one tomorrow. If there's a publisher out there who needs a children's book, I can create a children's book
with drawings within an hour.
Within an hour.
All right.
Because kids will read any stupid crap.
I thought he was pretty special. But you say that. Okay. Anyway, Dr. Zeus. Zeus.
I'm working on a sequel to The Grinch Who Stole Christmas. It's The Puerto Rican Who Stole My Car. And I'm with pictures.
Dr. Seuss, we'll miss you. Klaus Barbie. Fred, we'll miss you.
Klaus Barbie, that's the...
that's the Nazi.
That's the new Barbie doll with the German uniform. The Klaus Barbie.
Klaus Barbie, 77. He was the guy who was the Butcher of Lyon. That's how they dubbed him, what they dubbed him in World War II, during World War II. He was head of, I don't know, the occupying forces in France.
Right.
Or the city of Lyon. And they say he was responsible for thousands of deaths during his reign of terror. During his trial, he remained unrepentant. He said if he had 1,000 lives, he'd do it 1,000 times more. He didn't regret doing anything he had done. He was just happy to have served in the greatest army of the Third Reich.
Sounds like Fred back in the office.
So anyway, we don't have to worry about him anymore.
Right.
By the time they got him to trial, France had gotten rid of the death penalty, so all they could give him was life imprisonment.
You think they'd make an exception?
But no, they didn't.
No.
So they kept him until he died. He had cancer. Liz Taylor collapsed.
What's her problem?
I don't know. I've never seen a person this ill.
Yes, she
in
does.
My entire life.
We have tape of her collapsing.
says he was taking tea.
Maybe she saw who she was marrying and fell down.
Taking tea in Houston, where she was doing a promotional appearance to sell her newest perfume, White Diamonds. And she was on medication, as she normally is, for I don't know what, but all of a sudden...
As she normally is.
She's always on medication for
something. Right. So, they say she might have pneumonia again. How does she... Because she was... she got chilled or something.
Well, she's dehydrated.
Yeah. What is her problem? Drink a glass of water.
I have no idea why this woman can't keep her fluids in balance.
Right.
So anyway, she sort of started to hit the deck. They called the doctor. And when the doctor couldn't find a vein to start IV fluids on her, decided to rush her to the hospital. Yeah. She was turning blue.
Hey, what a great promotion. She saw a lot of bottles of perfume.
Yeah, I tell you.
So smell my beautiful new perfume. It's a knockout. If you're feeling blue. Hey, she's really turning blue. What a nutty situation.
Well, you
that
know
is.
She's supposed to get married in a few days. Who would want to marry this wreck?
Who? How about me for all that money? I ain't signing no prenup, I'll tell you that.
Lots of people are getting facelifts at a younger and younger age.
I know.
The average age for a facelift is dropping.
It's got to be about 40-something now, right?
People are getting them in their 30s and 40s.
And they don't even need them.
That's, well, what their excuse is, they're doing it before their face falls all the way.
Right. It's weird.
They're catching it, in other words, before it hits the ground. And they say both men and women are doing this.
Yeah.
And it's not only celebrities and the excessively vain.
No.
Many women are very family-oriented, but they're getting their faces lifted anyway. So... Who knows? I don't understand it. Would you ever do that?
Facelift?
Yeah.
I really don't think so. I mean, if I didn't go for the nose job, I ain't going for the facelift. I saw that operation on Donahue, and that's enough to make you never get it. They take your whole skin off your face and pull it tight.
They skin you.
Yeah, they skin you. And it's weird. It looks like a skin mask. And they pull it tight, and it's just, you know, I don't care how wrinkled. At that point, what do I care?
I don't know. You have to think about this.
I know I won't. I just know it. I'm not going
to suppose you start to age really badly. All of a sudden, like...
Suppose. Look at me. You've got some fun going on. I'm 37. I got a hairdo of a 19-year-old.
Oh, stop it. Suppose all of a sudden your face just started to wrinkle.
Yeah.
And you couldn't see your eyes anymore. They were, you know, all those skin flaps started to fold over. What
I don't know.
Do?
I really don't think I would, but... You see, in my mind, it's kind of like, even when I think about that nose job, I go, hey, okay, I'm 37, right? How many more years do I really have to live? So why go through all that hassle? I should have done it when I was 19 or something. Because to do it now, what's the payoff? Am I going to get laid? Oh, I'm going to look better on television. I don't want to be on television anymore. So what's the difference? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but...
I got to have a payoff. It's like even, like now I'm trying to lose weight. And the reason I'm trying to lose weight is simple. It's I got a lot of nice clothes that I bought when I was thin, and I want to be able to fit back into them. So I have a motivation.
Sure. But let's say this, all right? You lose the weight, and all of a sudden...
Right.
Your skin doesn't snap back.
I see. Honestly, I can tell you, I don't think I'd ever get a facelift. You know, again, you know, it's just like I said, if I was bald, I wouldn't get a toupee.
Yeah.
But you know...
You
who
get
knows?
A toupee.
Yeah, right.
You
all
mean
right.
Weaving and hair transplanting and everything
right.
else.
What do you mean? Doctor, you told me if I rub this gel on my head, I'll get hair. And I'm using the suction cup every night. I don't understand what's going wrong. You know, it's nothing. There's no new hairs. Oh, there are new hairs. Where? Oh, you mean these are new? Oh, thank you. All right, we'll be back right after these words.
You know, it seems now that more and more people are making the switch. 94 WYSP, Howard Stern all morning, classic rock and roll all day.
Okay, happening college. Uh-huh. I think it happened in college.
Uh-huh.
Oh. Maybe it was high school. Was it high school or college?
It didn't happen in high school.
All right, it didn't happen in high school, so it happened
in college.
It must
have been college.
No, I mean, nothing happened in college. It didn't happen in high school.
It didn't happen in high school, okay. He's driving around with his friends, his buddies.
Yeah.
Right?
It's Howard.
He was never alone.
Did you ever hear of something called a harvest moon?
Yes. But it's up in the sky.
No. Oh, no. I had never heard of this. Jackie claims when he was in high school.
I don't claim anything.
All right. Well, you told me this, and now he claims it's not true.
All right. This was a legend he heard, and he put himself in the story,
some
but he didn't really do it.
He did this.
All right. He mooned some guy. Because I said, after he told me this, I said, you never told me this before. He goes, yes, I did. I go, because this is unbelievable.
Go ahead.
All right. He hung, you know, he mooned. I forget the why was the reason that he mooned these guys? But there was no reason.
He was mooning a bunch of guys.
I think so. He was driving by in a car. Now I don't even remember the whole story. Maybe Ronnie does. He can call in with it. If he's not driving some big celebrity. Ronnie drives a lot of big celebrities.
Really?
Yeah. He's got a whole bunch of people in his car.
Who'd you tell me he had the other day?
Like Rivers Phoenix or something.
Really?
Yeah. I said, you smell his fingers? She'd like, that's got to be getting incredible action. I said, Dave Rivers, no tip, but just let me smell your hand. But anyway, where was I?
You're not going to tell me Jackie's story?
Yeah. Okay. So he's driving around, and he hangs his butt cheeks out the window, the moon.
Oh,
yeah.
No.
And he goes to the bathroom.
Oh,
stop it!
Right out the window.
That is disgusting. He didn't do
And then
that.
He did something even more disgusting after
what?
That.
What's more disgusting?
That's not even the disgusting part. I'm just trying to think how I can tell you this.
Did he stop?
So, no, the guy who was driving was, like, flipping out that Jackie was doing this.
You know, wait a minute. The car moving? Is the car moving?
Car is moving.
So doesn't this go down?
No, he's firmly out the window.
But still, you know.
Get that far out.
Right. It flies back and
gymnast.
Hits.
He was a gymnast in high school. He did it.
The good news is my mother was in the back seat.
I don't think your mother ever wants to drive behind you again.
Jackie used to do a lot of stuff out car windows. I mean, he would go on long drives and drink beer. No, he wasn't driving, but he would be in the passenger seat, drink a lot of beers.
That was his job on the trip.
And since they were going all the way to Michigan, he would have to go to the bathroom in a bottle, but then he'd throw it out the window and it hit his mother in the face.
Right. So I'm saying the same back thing into happens.
Well, no, that didn't happen. He did his mission, but then
he probably was.
See, I don't know that I could describe this on the air. It's pretty gross.
Time for a pay-per-view hour.
Yeah. I might need to go on, like, Channel J and talk about this. I can't talk about the rest of it. There's no way I can figure out where
to
tell you.
Did it involve a windshield?
Yes. Yes.
He mentioned this story to me a long time
ago.
It involved a windshield.
So I got a feeling this is true.
In other words, he used the windshield as toilet paper.
Yeah.
Okay.
What?
Well, I can't describe what he did.
A towel. Maybe that would be a better description.
He used the windshield as a towel. That's it.
One step removed.
There was a transfer. I'll tell you off the air.
Did he ever just drive in a car and sit in a seat?
I'll tell you right now.
He's crawling all on the outside of the car.
No luck there.
The guy that was driving, I'm sure, is listening right now, and he's probably dying all over again.
Did you have a problem?
What's his name? Maybe he'll call in. Mike, right?
Mike Iacovelli.
Mike, why don't you give him a call? Maybe we can talk about it.
He's a big X-ray equipment salesman now, so I don't know if he'd admit it.
Well, he didn't do anything. It was you who did it.
It's his fault.
No.
Maybe he doesn't want to admit that he even knows Jackie.
Yeah, right. I don't want to admit I know Jackie.
Man.
One of those high school things, you know?
Yeah, sure, everybody did.
Yeah.
One of those high school things.
You know what this guy named Jimmy Cristiano was driving the other car, and it was a bunch of guys.
I don't know if it's necessary to name
everyone.
Yeah,
we don't need all that.
No, I know he's in Los Angeles, and he's probably listening, too, and
all right.
It's funny.
Is that one of your songs? Where you have
what do you mean? Another guy was driving another car?
There was people from Syosset in one car, and people from Oyster Bay in another car, and they were from another high school, and so you just try.
There's a rivalry.
You do things to outrageous each other.
Right.
You know, and they had recently taken us to a bakery where we were throwing used baked goods at cars.
Right.
And so we would.
So they were driving alongside, so you hung your butt out the window and went to the bathroom.
You know, you try and impress your.
Were they freaking out? I mean, were they laughing the hardest? I mean, I would laugh like out of my mind if I saw
you'd
that.
You'd probably have had an accident.
Oh, I would die.
I don't know that those people are still alive.
Oh, I mean, I would just like.
They never spoke to me again.
I would never be able to make another joke because that would be the funniest thing I ever saw.
Jackie's always got to be outrageous.
Yee-wee! 30 years ago.
Yeah. But the funniest part is sort of indescribable.
Well, you're going to tell me after the show.
Yeah, sure. You tell me how far you went with that soap opera boyfriend of yours.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Drawing a blank, huh? All right.
But somebody who does know how far they went is Kim Alley.
All right.
This woman who had Kim a Alley. Date with Donald Trump.
Right.
New model in Donald's life. She's talking to everyone.
She's weird.
She says that now she's going to ask Donald out for a date tonight or Friday because he's not used to that kind of treatment. She thought it would be nice in a 90s sort of way.
I think she's honest.
She claims now that they had their first real date on Tuesday. But in Richard Johnson's column today, Trump denies that it was a real date. He was at Raoul's on Prince Street on Tuesday night.
He ought to be
dining
working.
With friends.
Yeah.
And she just popped in and sat down at the table. Now, how would she know where he was?
Exactly. Someone had to tip her off.
Anyway, Alley Cat is already booked on the Geraldo show.
Wow.
She met Trump on Friday at a party at the home of some New York club owner, and Tuesday she joined Trump at Raoul's at a downtown spot. Now, either it was a date, or she just sort of popped over to his table and he didn't throw her out. But he wanted to stress to everyone that they left separately. So anyway, she's now changed modeling agencies and has a new publicist.
She got like the guy kissed her goodnight, and she's building a career.
No, don't we all know her name now?
Alley Cat, yeah, Kim Alley, Alley Cat.
Yeah. So she does need a new agent and a new publicist. Trump now says she'll be a star. Only one problem: he won't be there.
Can't blame the guy.
A little bit upset about all the publicity she's gone after since just kissing him one night in a limo.
She'll talk pretty much to anybody.
Yeah. But she says that she probably needs a little guidance into how to handle things publicly. That's why she got this new publicist.
How did she know she was going to be kissed by a famous guy?
Boy, oh boy. But she says he's a great kisser. It's good advertising for him.
There you go.
So there, Alley Cat.
Like, that's a real difficult thing to be, a kisser. Like, that's a hard thing. He's a great kisser. Yeah, I think if you got a lot of money in your pocket, you're a great kisser. I think that automatically makes you a pretty good one.
And she swears they haven't gone any further than that. So.
He's a great kisser. Fred's a great kisser. Nobody knows that better than me.
What would you do about this situation? In Redwood City, California, this guy who has an estate of about $1 million died. Okay? He was an auto repair shop owner.
Yeah.
Died of a heart attack 4 months ago. And when, you know, they called relatives to come pick up the body, his wife, Laura, went to claim his body at the coroner's office. But then so did wives Paulina and Killy.
Allie Killy? Allie Cat? Wife Allie Cat.
So apparently this guy has
three wives.
Lots of wives and five kids, and none of the wives knew that they were sharing him with anyone else.
Wow.
They each thought they were the sole beneficiary of his estate.
And he has $1 million, and he's an auto repair guy.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, he owned the shop.
Wow. I know.
Can you imagine having that secret of life that you had four, five, six wives?
Who could imagine that? I'm busy imagining that an auto repair shop owner has $1 million. I'm just
you
totally.
You can't get that one.
I'm obsessed on that. Did he ever hang his butt out of a car window?
Well, what's the judge supposed to do, Howard?
Oh, you want a decision on this? Well, obviously they're going to take the money and split it equally among his. First of all, you have to read the will. But since this guy was doing something illegal, like having all these families, what they'll do is they'll rule and split the money evenly between the different families.
Oh, I don't think so.
Really?
I think that you're being, you're using common sense again and not dealing with the law.
What does the law say?
The law says that your first wife is your wife. Those other wives aren't wives.
Wow. Well, it's be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah, we'll have to see. There's going to be a hearing on November 21st. We'll have to see how it goes. And finally, out of Prince George's County, a 73-year-old man has been indicted by a grand jury on charges that he sexually assaulted a 70-year-old woman at a Greenbelt nursing home last month. Can you believe this?
A 73-year-old man?
Yeah, he was assaulted. Visiting someone at the nursing home.
Hmm.
And he just sees this woman, you know, lying in her bed. She's mentally impaired and unable to comprehend what's going on.
The easiest ones to get. Don't
so,
I know?
I guess he just, you know, said, why not?
I used to do that. When I was in college, I went to stupid girls' colleges just to get them. I went to the dumbest girls' college I could find.
Oh, stop.
I told you that night and I didn't score. I sat in the lounge.
Still couldn't score.
I sat in the lounge and watched dumb TV shows with dumb girls and had dumb conversation.
A witness told police she saw this guy enter the woman's room and saw him assaulting her in the bed.
Wow.
So they obtained a warrant for his arrest.
73. And, so I guess you're really horny at 73.
I guess that lasts you all your life.
Yeah. God, that's a curse.
So that's what's happening.
All right. 941. We'll be back with your phone calls right after these words. Don't go away.
All day.
If you don't like what you hear, then hang up the phone and forget about it, okay? You'll like what they say. 212-794-2200. 212-794-2200. That's 212-794-2200. With locations in New York, New Jersey, Long Island, and Westchester. Physician Smoke Stopping Group. 10 in front of 10. 92.3 K-Rock. WISP. WJFK. We're going to go to New York first. We're going to go to Los Angeles, then Philadelphia and Washington, Robin. That's the order I'm going to go in right now.
New York, Los Angeles, Philly, and Washington.
Hello?
That is correct.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes, good morning. My name is Mark.
You're on the air.
Thank you. I wanted to talk to him about Washington's Initiative 119. It's about the...
Lower your radio. You're giving numbers out and you don't know what you're talking about.
Yes, hello. I wanted to talk to him about...
Yeah, lower the radio. It's me.
Oh, hi. How are you?
Yes.
Fine. Listen, I just read this morning in the newspaper that they want to start the ability so that you could kill yourself.
Yes.
All on your own.
You need that. You
you believe in that? You're
I think this is a man who's trying to keep that law off the books because he might use it.
Yeah, if that becomes the law, of course.
You want to get something out of your parents and put them away or what?
I'm sorry?
I said, in my opinion, they're going to wind up, giving the initiative to individuals to try to kill off their parents early.
All right, listen to me. Obviously, you're being serious here. Now, look, how many people are in the United States? Do you know?
200 million.
How many?
200 million.
That's right.
See, I can't understand how many people...
If half of them commit suicide, it'll be fine.
Half of them commit suicide? That's
what
I
think. Are you worried about if someone... Why are you worried about if somebody wants to kill themselves? You know what my biggest problem is with people who want to kill themselves? They always want to kill themselves and jump out a window and land on me.
They always want to jump out...
I would like a suicide bill which says there's a place they can go and kill themselves safely with a lethal injection... At a place under a doctor's care where they can go out peacefully.
But that new book that came out can show you how to do that. I don't know why.
Yeah, but that's all with prescription drugs.
Yeah.
Just take the drugs or do something to that effect.
And it's against the law for a doctor to prescribe them.
You can't go to a doctor and get them.
Giving the initiative to do it.
All right, what is your... Listen, you know what? I don't even know what your point of view is on this.
Well, my point of view is that once you legalize it, people are going to abuse it. If you really want to take your own life, just do it yourself.
Oh, I see. You want it kept illegal so that people will continue to kill themselves on their own. But I'm telling you, when people kill themselves on their own, they end up...
They botch the job a lot.
A lot of them drive off a road and crash into your car. I want to live. I'm into living. I like life.
I want my family to make that decision for me. You know what I'm saying?
You want... Wait, let me get to this. You keep harping on family. Now, what is this about your family?
Now, see, what they're going to do is allow your family to make that decision.
No, that's bad.
Wait a minute. What are you saying? In cases where you're in a coma and you're lying in the hospital,
exactly.
The family could come along and say, yeah, take off all the...
No,
I'm
against that.
Take me off the tube.
No. Now, here is the law that I want. Somebody wants to kill themselves, they got to be able to say, look, I want to kill myself. Right, if I'm laying in a hospital and I'm in a coma,
right,
and I'm hooked up to tubes minding my own business,
sure.
Who the hell is my wife to see? You know what my wife's going to be thinking? Oh, you know what I'm in here? I got to spend some dough here.
I'm
keeping
so
him
tired of hanging around this hospital.
Oh, my God. It's such a hardship. It's so hard on us. I'm sure Howard would want it this way. No.
Now, here, if you come
what I
that.
Want... Shut up! You asked me a question. I can't get the answer
go
out.
Go ahead.
What's the matter with you?
Go ahead.
What I want is a nurse should flip me over every couple of hours so I don't get bed sores. Keep me hooked up to the strongest IV you got going.
That's right.
And let me breathe that beautiful fake oxygen that they got that they pump right down your throat.
There you go.
You don't want to live like that, Howard.
Keep me alive until the last cell has rotted away because I'm going to tell you something. The way medical science is going and the innovations going on in the computer age, there's a very good chance that a cure could be found for me.
Exactly. That's
and
my belief.
And I told my wife, and I'm telling any doctor who lives here, Robin, God bless you, you're listening to me so you can tell everyone this when I'm in the hospital.
I don't want to be pulled off the plug.
Well, let me tell you while everyone's listening.
Go ahead, Robin.
I do.
Good. Don't touch me.
Don't leave me hanging around
leave
to
me.
Rot.
Because I don't know what else is out there.
I
this might be the best thing going.
Leave me around and let them let me know. Let me make the decision.
Exactly.
My wake up.
Right.
Not somebody else.
What
if you don't wake up?
It's such a.
If I don't wake up,
I'll be dead anyway. So
right.
I'm listening. What else
natural.
I got to do? Might as well hang on and wait for a chance.
We can't remove one tube.
Not one tube.
Don't
those
remove
are my
one.
Tubes.
In fact, give me more than one tube.
Those are my tubes.
Give
I
me
have to be
that's right. You're exactly right. Now I understand what you're talking about.
Yeah, this it's called the Washington's Initiative 119. It should go. Into effect sometimes this month, they're voting on it.
Most families, they sit there around the bed. Let me tell you what happens.
Sure.
They sit there around the bed, and right away the wife, oh, my God, he would want to be dead. This is terrible. You know, first couple of days they come to the hospital. Oh, don't unhook him. He could. I've read miracle cases. Then suddenly they get a bill. Medical insurance informs them that things are running out. You might have to dip into your own pocket, etc. So right away, oh, well, we got to do what's good for the family. We don't want the children to suffer, see their father like this. Don't bring the kids around. You leave the kids out of it. Tell them I dropped dead, okay? You know what I say to my wife? You don't even have to come to the hospital because I'm not going to know you're there anyway. Let me lay there like a lox. If you're feeling good about me, you know, if you're not remarried that quick, check on me once a month. Make sure they're not abusing me sexually or something while I'm in my sleep.
You can only hope.
Yeah, you know, some guys like, you know, comes in later, like some nurse, male nurse comes in and starts putting his pud where it don't belong.
Oh,
while you're on a respirator.
While I'm on a respirator. That'd be great. Oh, terrific. Yeah, I'm laying there. I'll roll him.
Then what a picture.
I'll roll him over. No need to say. No. Everybody clear out. I'll roll him. You know, keep everybody away from my sphincter, all right? Put in a sphincter alarm, if you would. Put in one of those low jacks. Right in there. So you can track me.
Sure.
I want some kind of alarm. Anybody goes there, like a low crack. low jack, low crack. So, and once in a while, check in on me, make sure they're, you know, that they're, you know, doing the right thing.
You don't
me.
Know what you're asking for.
Yeah, but see, now your family will be checking on you. And then why should they be involved in any of the other decisions?
Of course.
If they care, they're going
I'm an adult.
To, if they don't.
My wife isn't involved in any decisions now. I don't want her involved in any decisions
but
later.
But you don't know what you're asking for. That's
my wife,
what I'm saying.
My wife don't even know me that well. Believe me, she wouldn't know what I want. I don't ask her.
Excuse me, Howard, while you're laying there racked with infection.
What infection? I don't know that I'm racked with infection. Am
well,
I?
Well, when you lay around, you get pneumonia.
Yeah, or you don't know that you're
hey,
or you get
my darling,
urinary tract infection.
Prop me up on a few pillows and let the fluid drain out of my lungs. All right? I know exactly what I'm talking about.
Howard,
I've examined all
Howard,
issues.
Howard.
Even if I was 90 years old and I didn't have all my wits about
of
me,
course.
I wouldn't want my family.
Okay, let's all right.
No one should make that decision for you.
It's a gruesome thing, but
you want that decision made for you, write it down on a piece of paper.
Exactly.
Put it in a will or some kind of thing, or not a will, a living will.
That's what they call it, a living
will. Put it down and worry about your own damn legislation.
Right. Now they call it, you know, your own death right. You
all
can
right.
make that yourself, but you shouldn't have someone else doing it for you.
Now, let me tell you something about it. Now, you just got to understand something.
You wouldn't even allow your medical doctors to make
no.
the decision.
No way. No.
He shouldn't be given
because a lot of medical doctors don't realize the advances that science is making. They're set in their ways. And there could be a cure for me.
A cure for what?
Whatever
now
it is
your
I
body's
got.
Totally useless.
Whatever I have.
Muscles have wasted away.
Good. I'll build up. I'll pump up once I get better.
They come up with a medicine.
You bring up a good
back
point.
To normal.
All right. Thank you. I think we've discussed this
it was
long
nice
enough.
Talking with
very
you.
Good.
Easy now.
God bless you.
So long.
Yes.
Well, once again, I say, don't save me.
Nobody asked you. They asked me. I'm telling you what I want.
Just letting my preference be known.
I'll unhook you right now if that's what you want. 9:58, we'll be back right after these words.
Classic rock and roll all day.
Ready?
That Andy's so wacky, already having a sale.
Isn't he a wacky guy? Isn't he a fun guy? I got to get to know him better. If you prefer, you think we could set up a dinner, Robin? If you prefer a Mazda, you can still get up to $2,000 cash back on 5.9% APR financing. Andy Photos with the complimentary loaner car program with a service appointment for all of his customers. And you, this is a guy who knows how to treat his people well. This is Hackensack Ford Mazda. Remember the name Hackensack Ford Mazda. If you really want to get a great price and be treated well afterwards. Remember I told you there was a guy up here yesterday, 2 days ago, who was possessed by Satan?
Mm-hmm.
And then we couldn't get in touch with him on the phone. He's here.
Excellent.
Why do they always come at 10 o'clock, though?
I don't know.
I mean, no offense, this is Meg's show.
Well, maybe Meg can interview.
No, it is. We end up going late every day. People start to think that we're on.
I know. It's hell 11.
Is she really out of it?
Well, he's a little bit more into it than he was 2 days ago, but it was interesting. I said, you know, so you're possessed? And he goes, well, it's really weird. You know, he goes, I can think of something in my mind and then make it happen.
Hmm.
So I said, well, what do you mean? He goes, well, say, for instance, we were just listening to the radio out in the lobby.
Right.
Say, for instance, I'll say now Howard's going to sound like Elmer Fudd. And then he starts talking like this. And I said, but I mean, he wasn't being
right,
goofy.
Right.
And I said, well, does everyone hear this or just you? And he goes, I don't know.
Oh, boy. Oh, man, you keep your eye on this. Hold on a second.
You going to bring him in?
Let me get prepared for this guy.
Okay. How do you prepare?
Well, no, I'm just kidding. I got to get ready. I got to psychologically get ready. So,
is this an old guy, young guy?
He's a young kid. He must be about 21 or 22. And he's got the receptionist and some of the female staff scared to death.
Gary told me something weird. He said that imbecile Bob Grant was talking about me on the air.
Uh-huh.
But he just makes stuff up.
Oh, really?
Either he's completely senile.
What did he make up?
Tell Robin the story.
Well, remember when he was on Howard's birthday show?
Yeah.
They had asked Howard about doing some sort of a roast that was going on for him, and we declined it. And that was the last, we never spoke again about it.
Uh-huh.
And he was saying how I kept calling up, saying Howard's coming, that he's not coming, that he is coming, and then that I demanded a limousine and a whole bunch of other stuff, and, you know, how Howard's too hot because he needs a limousine.
I don't even know what this guy's talking about.
I haven't spoken to anyone over there in 6 months.
Why would I go to a roast of his?
What are you doing? It sounds more like you're adjusting over there than getting ready.
Yeah, I'm okay. I'm ready now.
You ready?
Yeah. Okay,
Robert, we're going to be talking to Robert, the possessed guy.
Okay, cool. Why couldn't this happen at 6:30?
I know.
If you're possessed, do you really, what are you, did you make a 10 o'clock appearance?
That doesn't mean you care about our ratings. I don't think possession is really like that, Howard. That's the movie.
Oh. You just think this guy's a mental case. He's just hallucinating.
Well, you know, the Catholic Church says they have been performing exorcisms.
And what are the three rules? Remember, the Church has three rules to decide if they speak in tongues.
Right. They have to speak some language they don't know.
A language they don't know.
They have to do... What was it? What were they?
Community service.
No.
So they have to do an air shift on WJFK. All right. Take a seat. All right, now just calm down, all right? Just calm down. Come and sit down. Relax. Yeah, you don't look that...
No.
Are you really possessed by Satan?
Hello. How you doing? Did I keep my headphones on?
Yeah.
Are you a big fan of the show?
Did I keep them on my head?
Yeah.
Okay.
No problem.
Hey.
Making me nervous. Hey, now you're shaking around. Is this supposed to be the devil in you?
No, it's more like... It's a bunch of people, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Believe me, I know what you mean.
Can they keep your head rolling around like that?
Where's she coming from?
In your head.
Where you hiding?
Where
okay,
she?
Where is she? All right, there she is.
Don't get nervous. She ain't devil. She's just a person. Yeah.
On the way in, he said that we have it wrong. You know, he says I'm not possessed.
Oh, no.
What? Satan just got freaked out.
I am.
So what did you say?
On the way in, he said, you know, you got it wrong. I'm not possessed. And I said, well, that's what you wrote on your note. And I said, then what are you? He goes, well, I made a deal. And I said, with who? And he said, you don't want to know.
Oh, really? So you're not possessed?
Hello.
Hey, you might need some help. You get any help?
You got a doctor?
Not from anybody.
Really?
Nope.
You're doing this all on your own?
Yep.
What's the deal he made? I don't want to know who you made it with.
Yeah, what's the deal?
Well, the deal is...
It's hard to get dates with you. Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I can't get a date. Can't get anything.
I might hook you up with a girl.
Please.
I might hook you up.
Women have enough problems.
That would be a real challenge. If I could get you a date.
If
I could get you a date, I could get anybody a date. I'm telling you.
It's a challenge. I'm telling you right now.
Have you ever had a woman?
Huh? You bet.
You're not a bad-looking guy. You're a good-looking... He's not a
Never had a man, and I don't want one.
Right. Hey, Satan might be inside of
him. What about
you? No.
Nah, I didn't think so. Thank God.
Yeah.
The way he was frisking me before I came in, I was like, whoa, back off, mister. You are a mister, aren't you?
Yes.
Did he have a sex change, you know?
I don't know. All right, so wait a second. Now, who did you make a deal with?
No, what's the deal? He doesn't want to talk
about it. What is the deal? The deal, you could say what it is.
Because it's a pretty bad deal the way it's got you walking around.
Yeah. In other words, you made a deal with someone. We don't have to say who it is. But what was the deal that you made? Seriously. Can't say?
You can't even talk about
say.
The deal.
Can't say.
Can't say.
I don't know if I can get him.
Wait a minute. Do you live at home?
Well, nope.
Where do you live?
In a house?
You got your own apartment?
Nope.
You live in a house? What, like a mental
house?
A mental institution?
No.
You got roommates?
Roommates?
Yeah. One, two roommates.
So you must work in order to pay for this place.
Yeah, I do. I work. I make a lot of money. See, this isn't like a part of a gag or anything like that. It's not like I'm trying to make get attention or something like that.
Right.
I mean, I really don't need this.
Right.
It's just thrust upon me.
Right.
You know, it wasn't that something that I wanted. It wasn't something that I needed.
So
you know what I mean?
What do you do?
Yeah, what do you do for a living? What kind of work?
Actually, I could do anything now.
What do you mean? You're unemployed?
Yeah.
Oh.
Want to give me a job?
Well, first I'll get your girl, then we'll see about a job.
He's unemployed? How's he living?
Yeah. How are you making money?
Why do you always give the guests the crappy headphones?
Now, what kind of...
How do you get money to live?
Yeah.
I work. I can win things if I want. Do you want to know what the lottery numbers are?
Yeah. Okay. They have
something
good.
Yeah.
All right. Shh. Go ahead.
After the show, man.
You can give me the lottery numbers. Now, what else do you know from being possessed?
What do you want to know? Ask me a question.
Will Robin marry the soap opera guy?
No. I can answer that for you. I can see
ever drop the soap opera guy?
What? Speaking in tongues.
What did he
say? Hey, that's tongues.
Speaking in tongues?
Can you speak in tongues? If you can speak in tongues, that means
speaking in another language.
If you can speak in another language. Mis sabios te pesca en la cocina?
Je ne sais pas.
He's possessed.
Uh-oh.
Now, were you ever on drugs? Like, for example, this morning?
Like right now?
You ever do
no, not right now.
No.
No.
Have you ever done drugs?
Oh, of course. Hasn't everybody?
Well, maybe that's what got you into this state.
Hardly.
No, really? Now, how did you get into this position?
See, I should have talked to you before I went on the air, because now you're starting to make a big joke out of this.
No joke.
Joking.
I haven't joked. I don't think I have.
I don't even know what you've got.
Right.
See, I know. All right.
What is it, Gary?
Well, I'll just show you.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Ganji.
All right. What is this? Robert's roommate, Tammy, says he's lying? You mean just to get on the show?
I figured this was a scam.
Tammy is the biggest...
Liar?
Sack of...
Wait, don't say anything dirty.
I know.
Don't say anything.
I told that this morning.
All right, wait a second. Let me call her. Let me see what's going on. Now, what is, you
don't talk to Tammy.
Why?
Why not?
Wait a second.
She's like the
Let's talk to Tammy.
Let's find out. Let me find out what you're up to.
Auntie M.
Right,
like baby M, yeah? Baby bitch.
He knows a lot of inside jokes for a guy who's, you know...
Possessed.
Well,
hey, he's still a fan of the show.
I think he'd be preoccupied. Yeah.
You want some jokes?
With himself, if he were housing all those demons.
Is this Tammy?
No, it's not.
Yeah, can you put Tammy on the air? This is Howard Stern Radio Show calling. We're on the radio, tell her. Thank you, yes. Now, where the hell is it that... You got a female roommate?
Yeah, she's on the answering machine.
Well, then I'm going to get
that
possessed.
That doesn't put out...
Hello?
Hello?
Tammy, you're on the air.
Hey, Tam, how's it going?
Hi.
Tammy,
what are you calling me a liar for, huh? What is this?
Well, let me talk to Tammy.
Yes.
All right, what's going on here?
Then
okay,
how am I sitting
you want to know what's
room?
Going on?
Yes.
What's going on?
Okay, this person has been doing cocaine since Thursday of last week.
Now, is that true?
That is true.
Let me ask Robert if that's true.
He will not tell you the truth.
Is that true, Robert?
She...
He doesn't look like he's on anything.
You are not telling the truth.
Well, if he hasn't had any sleep at all, he's pretty wide awake.
Hey, yeah.
He's had maybe about 3 hours of it.
I'm sorry, what?
He's had maybe about 3 hours of it.
3 hours. Not bad.
I should
have had 3 hours of sleep. What do you think?
Thursday of last week.
Now, you guys are roommates, Robert?
Unfortunately.
Hey, Robert, sit down, will you?
Well, what does he do?
Robert, sit down.
What does he do when?
Right.
Okay. Well, how does he make a living? How is he paying the rent?
Yeah. Well, don't say where.
I own my own business.
Yes.
All right. That's good. That's good
on
enough.
3 hours of sleep.
What kind of business does he own? I mean, that, don't give me the name
work.
Of it.
Hey, Tammy.
He does what?
He Tammy? Does tile work.
Tile work?
Tammy.
Ceramic tile work.
I'm going to get you. You're going to burn for this one.
Oh, right. So, wait a second. He's not possessed. Does he want to be a comedian? Is that it?
No, he's got a problem with cocaine.
I got a problem with you.
Yeah, but why is he here?
Why is he here, then?
Because of his problem with cocaine. I don't know.
You should get her on it here.
If you do it enough, it'll screw you up.
and he's done it enough. That
just cool. Listen to her, man. She knows.
But you guys are roommates?
Unfortunately, yeah, but it won't be for long.
Oh, I see. You guys are trying to separate.
I'm trying to get him out of there as fast as possible.
Oh, I can see where you two want to get up. This is no love connection.
This will be time to go home tonight.
But were you guys once boyfriend and girlfriend? That
no,
you became, no.
Ever.
It's just that you guys hooked up and you became roommates.
Yes, through a friend.
Boy, this is some situation, huh?
I know.
Hey, this is life.
I know.
But does he go around in the apartment getting possessed and stuff?
Yeah.
Oh, he does?
Uh-huh.
Oh, so this act is not something he's just doing for us?
No.
Oh,
but
so
you say it's a drug thing.
Yeah, how do you know it's not Satan in there?
It.
Right?
It could be through, I don't know, he does so much cocaine you wouldn't even believe.
Has he made things move around the house or anything
no.
like that?
Nope.
Hey, yeah, Robert, can you make stuff move around the house and stuff? Can you make stuff move around the house?
What is going on over there?
He's going into a trance.
Yeah, yeah, watch it. Because, is he moving his head, shaking it back and forth?
Yeah,
okay, yeah, that's one of the signs.
One of the signs of what? I'm shaking my head. No.
When he does too much cocaine.
Okay, Tammy, which way? Shake your head, and I'll tell you which way you're shaking your head.
Okay, go for it.
All right, there we go. You're shaking your head.
Go for it.
He's gonna tell you. Wait a minute.
But tell the truth.
I'll tell the truth. Swear to God.
Go ahead. Wait, he's working.
Today, Robert.
Yeah, Robert, please, for radio.
Which way?
1 second, he's tuning into you.
I know.
He is now shaking his head like a wild man.
Yes, yes, I know, he does this.
All right, Robert.
Somebody slap him, I think we lost him.
Robert, you're still with us, pal? This is radio. Which way is she shaking her head?
I have people here watching me that will prove which way I'm shaking my head.
All right.
Yeah, they're going to come up with it before he does it.
Robert, what is your conclusion? Is that your conclusion?
What did he say? I turned down my radio. I can't hear him.
I tell you, I'm not moving into an apartment with him.
No. No. Well, I didn't know that before I moved in with him.
What do you say, Robert? What do you think?
I don't know.
Shake your head up and down.
What did he say?
Up and down?
Yep.
Up and down.
Okay. You want to know? I got four people here watching me, and I was not moving my head a bit.
Well, that's no good. That doesn't work.
Yes, it does.
He's full of crap. That means you might have been thinking up and down.
I always think
this
up and
this is something.
Down.
That's a weird thing.
We weren't until he started doing cocaine all the time.
I see.
Why don't we stop his head?
Right, switch headphones.
It was the headphones that threw him off.
Oh, sorry.
It was the headphones.
Yeah.
If you believe that, I'll tell you.
Well, put the headphones on just so you can hear Robin.
No, he can hear me, I'm sure.
Oh, he can hear.
Oh, he doesn't need headphones.
He doesn't need headphones, no.
So did you and Robert ever get romantically involved?
Are you kidding?
Thank God.
You never kissed her or anything?
Are you kidding? I would rather die first.
So why can't you guys hate each other?
How come you don't hang up on her?
Well, because I'm curious. If you guys hate each other so much, why don't one of you just move out?
Because I support a child by myself.
Not my fault.
No, I didn't say it was. And I have to get him out of there, and therefore I have to move.
I don't understand why she has to get me out of here.
Oh. Everybody wants to live with you.
All right, Tammy, thank you.
Hey, listen, Howard.
Uh-huh.
I'm the biggest fan of yours. I think you're great. I love you.
All right, thanks.
And Robin, too.
Oh, you better start blowing up your fan.
Bye.
Better
start what?
I don't know. No. Don't fans blow?
Right, hey, do me a favor. I want to do an experiment with you.
Do that.
I want Gary to take you in another room. I'll shake my head, and you tell me how I'm shaking my head.
Oh, how?
Can you just turn around?
What?
Can you just turn around?
I don't know. So, Robert, what are you going to do about this? Are you going to get...
What did you come here for? You showed up at the...
Yeah, how can I help you?
You said you had to tell Howard something?
Yes. Please. How can I help you? Seriously.
You'll never understand.
All right.
Besides, I'd rather talk about this another time.
Do me a favor. Go in another room and fire Gary, because he's no longer working for the show.
Ow!
So we could never understand anything, so it's not even worth going into.
No, see... To discuss this over the air is kind of ludicrous because...
It's too big a problem.
It's too extenuating. See,
it's this extenuating
goes on. This is a big thing.
Going on every day.
No.
every other
same
day.
Same thing every day.
Same thing.
It's like a record that plays in my head, and you can listen to it. You can learn from it. And yeah. I want somebody to record this because I don't know what the hell's going on. I really don't. I just do. Ask Tammy. It's been the same thing. I get
over and
bits,
over again?
I get bits and pieces, bits and pieces. Then all of a sudden last night, it ran through the whole thing. And I know how to start the album.
So you're saying if you can get someone to record
how to start it,
if you can get someone to record it.
And I know how to stop it.
See, if you could... Fred just fell down on the
he
floor.
He is moving things.
Dave, that was pretty good. Hey, Gary. If this guy... So how can we help you?
I think he wants to talk to you off the air.
All right. So why don't you let me wrap up the show and see if we can't talk to Robert afterwards, okay?
Okay.
All right.
All right, Robert.
All right, Robert. We'll take care of you.
Yeah.
Set him up somewhere.
Definitely.
All right. And get him a neck brace. I don't want you to hurt your neck like that.
Do I need a neck brace?
You might. I don't know. All right, Robert. We'll check in with you in a few minutes. Go ahead. Take care of him. All right. Thanks, Robert.
Follow me, man.
All right. There goes Robert.
Sorry about the frisky thing.
All right.
Up against
the
wall. Oh, man.
I was getting too weirded out, Robert. I'm sorry. I had to just get him out of here.
There's nothing wrong with him.
I don't know, but he was just weirding me out.
There's plenty wrong with him. He's stupid.
Yeah, that's really the only thing.
He was just freaking me out. You know what I'm saying? Wasn't he freaking you guys out? Like, it was like a little too weird.
I couldn't figure out where he was coming from at all.
Nah.
But I don't understand.
Goofing or what?
Nah. What's he supposed to be trying to be?
Weird.
He says he's possessed by Satan.
But the waggling your head around like that?
So what do you mean? What are you supposed to look like when you're possessed by Satan?
I don't know.
According to Tammy, he's just doing tons of coke and freaking himself out.
But the whole time, he was smirking.
Yeah, but I mean...
And every time he wanted to adjust the headphones, he could stop his head.
Yeah.
Now he's alone.
Yeah, but like, look at that guy who came up to see me from high school who was having like the hallucinations about the platelets and stuff. But at some point,
that guy never stopped.
Yeah, but he was kind of coherent every once in a while.
No.
No, I would say to because I even said to him, like, hey, what's happening? In the, you know, remember we were in high school with your brother? Oh, yeah, everybody's doing good. My brother's doing great. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, but the gut feeling on him was he was genuine. Didn't you think so?
Yeah, well, definitely.
Yeah.
You're his friend. Yeah.
Well, I don't know that this guy isn't having hallucinations, this kid.
He can put down a floor of tile.
I don't know about that.
I don't know. Your friend couldn't have laid any tile.
No,
I don't think.
Jimmy Fink is here, and he is so heavily perfumed, I'm
really?
Going to pass out.
He smells like Cher, Mike.
You smell like Cher.
No, my head's wobbling.
It's not her perfume.
Now everybody in the room is
now Gary's going to go, okay, what do you want? The guy's waiting for
it. Yeah. Oh, he's waiting for it.
I hope Gary can read my signals.
That's why I came in here, Howard. I don't want to put in the room with a possessed
I'm not really looking to meet with the guy.
I know, it's just going to be hard to get him to go now.
Come here. Come on. You'll get rid of him.
Yeah.
Okay, Okay, Gary, what's your read on that guy?
What the girl said.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Hey, you.
Oh. Jimmy, Jesus Christ.
What did you do, really Jimmy?
Bring back that guy and get Jimmy out of here.
Richard Simmons and Rossi were here. We died.
Oh, my God. Jimmy, why are you so... I don't understand. Actually, I'm being serious. I don't mean it offensively.
Actually, I accidentally dumped a little too much in my hand.
You're
Howard.
A perfume guy. I mean, I don't get the... Listen, when I'm with a woman who's heavily perfumed, I can pass out. My head starts to spin. But if a woman has, like, a little bit of perfume on her...
Serious,
and suddenly you're making out with her...
broke.
Yeah?
That you've squished itself, yeah. So I poured a little out in my hand, but it just came splashing out.
But why not
what am I supposed to do?
Why
like,
come
shower
to K-Rock and wear
oh,
a
I
scent?
Oh, I should stay home.
No, I'm saying, why not
you
just smell like yourself?
In your average life, you don't need to smell good.
Yeah, I mean, as a married man, let's say when he comes home and maybe he wants to get romantic with his wife, maybe splash on a little aftershave or something if she likes it.
Uh-huh.
But why just come to work and working in such a closed room? Why do you want to smell so sweet?
Well, I didn't want to smell this sweet, Harry.
Yeah, I know, but if I'm saying even...
Why smell sweet at all is what he
why
saying.
Even bother with it?
Wash them up at all.
I don't know.
All right, Jimmy, it's
sort of like
it's oppressive.
Sorry.
Let me clear the air.
Oh,
all right.
Well, that smells better, Howard.
No, it's better. Some of these guys with their smells are oppressive. I mean, Steve Rossi's oppressive. You become part of the smell. You begin to stink.
You get that smell on you. You can't get it off.
And my headache has already kicked in. No, I'm serious. I get like an immediate reaction. Could I be allergic to this stuff? I mean, I get an immediate like kind of...
I think you have a very sensitive nose.
Nagging headache.
Should I go in there on Robin's side and see if she concurs with him?
Just do me a favor.
Stink?
Yeah, do me a favor. Just walk over to Robin. Okay. No, I don't mean
I'm
any
just
offense.
Just walk through there.
It's not like it's your natural smell. It's something you can cure.
What it is when a door opens, Howard.
Yeah, oh my God. Just let him stay in the room for a while.
All right.
Let him stand there for a while.
Jeez.
Hi, right. Jimmy. Right. I don't smell you yet.
No, no, it'll waft over.
Sauntered through the room.
What? What's
going on?
Oh, boy.
Oh, man.
That's heavy.
I was afraid you guys wind up nude. Is it maybe Robin will like it?
Well, it is a little strong, Jim.
Wow.
It still smelled, Robin,
yes,
now that I've left.
I've got you in my room now.
And now he opened the door and it's shut. It'll like...
Yeah. I mean, it's really here now.
Sorry.
It's like a stinky comet.
Well, I apologize.
Like, you know, he's like one of those things you get in magazines.
Right. He smells like New York Magazine. You know, Richard Simmons is like a stinky comet. He comes like breezing through, like whoosh.
And he leaves his scent behind.
Yeah, it's like, and it's on your clothes. And Steve Rossi hugs me. That's it. For the whole rest of the day,
you
I smell
Steve
like him.
You have Steve with you the rest of the day.
Yeah.
Did you notice it when I just came in before during commercials, Howard, when I walked in to get something?
No, as a matter of fact, I didn't until after you left the room and Jackie went, whoosh, and I go, it doesn't, Jimmy's perfume wasn't strong. I don't smell it. And then I'm talking to Fred, and all of a sudden, wham, it hits you.
Well, it hits me first. When the door closes, it fans it into me, and then the cloud hits you.
Yeah. But it's still in this room, Jim. Hmm.
Could I tell you?
So from 10 to 2 today here in New York, we'll be hearing Jimmy stink.
And I'm not one who objects to a man smelling good, but that is strong.
Well, because I actually spilt it out of my hand. It was, you know, the thing broke.
I don't know.
No, I'm serious, Howard.
All right. Okay. All right, we'll accept
that. Would I make up something like that?
Whatever gets you through the day.
You know, you just should keep running through the entire building. You can be an air freshener for the entire building.
Yeah, really.
Well, some of the floors need it, you know?
I walked in on, this was weird, yesterday. I go into the men's room after the show.
Oh, man.
And I, Fred was in one of the stalls, sitting down.
Yeah.
And it just finished going, and there was a guy next to him. Now, I didn't hang around long enough to find out who was next to you, Fred. Do you have any idea?
No, but it was pretty foul. I tried to get away.
But I don't know if that was you or the guy. I got a feeling it was the guy next to you.
It was pretty bad.
It smelled like death. If death had an odor, it smelled like the color gray. You know what I mean? Like a gray decaying. You ever been to like an old age home and an old person has to be bathed and they haven't been bathed in 3 days? And you gotta like lift them onto the bed or something and this is what it smelled like in there. And it was so foul. For a bathroom not to have a window is disgraceful. It's disgraceful. I don't know who was in there. Allison Steele.
Stop it. In the men's room.
No, I'm just kidding. She was way gone. It was one of the guys.
Probably a salesman. It
wasn't me.
Salesman. It felt like a salesman. I don't know, but it was, and it wasn't Jackie, because Jackie's bad, but this was death.
Yeah, I'm a party.
I don't know why.
You know, the scary thing yesterday.
Why not run out of the room? Why stay in there and drink it in?
No. And you know what? I made a mistake. I don't know what was going through my head. I was making a joke to myself. I went, la da da. And I went, And I sucked in a lot of air. And wow. I mean, it was a wallop. I would have welcomed Jimmy Fink stink right there.
You wish I had come in.
You're not kidding.
But what was scary is when you came into the office and said, Fred, what was that in there? And you said, I know it wasn't you, Fred, because I know what you smell.
Of course, he's examined every one of your smells.
I got to test you guys every month.
He's got like a chart.
Well, it's not like we haven't all spent a lot of time together. Probably way too much time.
I know it wasn't Fred, and I know it wasn't Jackie. It's like,
you know, don't forget, I go way back with Fred. Fred's lived with me.
He's been smelling him for a long time.
Yeah. Way back.
I can tell you a lot of stuff about Fred. Well, one of the things is, he don't stink like that.
Unless Fred had drastically changed his diet, that wasn't him.
Once in a great while.
This is a guy who just eats cashews. I don't think it smells like that from that.
Meet a pizza will do it. So.
Tomorrow I'll read you. I got so much stuff to read you, Robin. I'm backed up. Clint Holmes, the new host of that Channel 9 show. The guy from Steppin' Out Magazine did an interview with him. It's pretty funny. But don't promise me you won't read it before tomorrow.
I haven't seen it, and I won't read it before tomorrow.
All right.
But after that,
good girl. Wow, Jimmy. You am stinky. I don't wear any scent. And I'll tell you something. I'm very comfortable with my own odor. I wear a deodorant, probably the best deodorant on the market. I use a Ban roll-on.
Mm-hmm. Why is it the best?
Dry Idea roll-on.
Why is it the best?
You want to be honest?
Sure.
It's the best because it goes on, and it's not sticky and wet when it goes on. It's very dry. And it goes on, and it covers any odors whatsoever. You know, in other words, any odors that might come up are not there for the whole day. The whole day I'm dry. And I'm not
don't
someone.
Don't most deodorants do that?
No.
Oh.
A lot of them, the spray-ons don't do that for me.
Okay.
And don't forget, I shave my armpits a little bit. So the deodorant can get on the hairs. Or get under the hairs. But, you want to know the best hair conditioner? Because Fred and I were arguing about this.
Oh, really?
Fred thinks it's Paul Mitchell. It's not.
What?
Paul Mitchell doesn't work good. It's called Nexus.
You think Nexus?
I know it.
But
that's the only hair conditioner that can get through the tangles.
Okay.
In one quick... You use Nexus, Jimmy?
Well,
not that you have
it.
A lot of tangles.
I have used it.
You barely have hair. You sure do smell, but I'll tell you that. Now I know why
you
that...
You got a scent.
Now I know why that Liz Taylor passed out.
Why? If you're smelling her perfume?
Because she probably... For a perfume appearance, she's probably covered with the stuff.
And so is everybody else in the room. Probably.
Right. And she passed out. I'm ready. I have a headache from you. I'm not saying it to be... I'm not saying it for effect. I have a headache.
Prepare the bed next to Liz. Howard's coming.
I could not sleep with you, Jimmy.
I know you're broken up by that.
Yeah. I saw your wife the other day. She's still looking cute. Jimmy's wife is always cute.
Always does.
Mm. She married a runway.
She would also complain about that I smelt.
You bet.
Too much.
Any woman would.
Yeah.
You're a good guy, but there's only so much you can put up with. Hey, he's better than Donald Trump. He's got plenty of money. From Fink Bakeries. He's a multimillionaire. Mm-hmm. He's got this little stupid disc jockey job that enables him to go backstage at concerts. He's like the perfect husband.
Oh, yeah.
Perfect catch. Best man in America. Right there, Jimmy Fink.
Unfortunately, he was the one that got away.
If some woman was smart, boy, she worked full-time on seducing him. Try to become an intern at the station.
He's already got a wife. What do you say?
And then become Jimmy's intern.
Oh,
and
no.
Then try to get him to leave his wife.
No, no, no. They're very happy.
Imagine if Helen Keller walked into this room. Here's a woman. Her only operating sense is her sense of smell. Everything else is going kablooey.
Burned out.
Yeah, and then Jimmy's in the room, and she's like, bonking into the wall, you know, completely thrown off.
Is Helen my intern today?
Yeah.
She'll have no trouble finding you.
If I was a girl, boy, that'd be worth a good month or two of my time to try to seduce Jimmy Fink and marry him.
Jeez. He's a happily married man. He can't be swayed, can you, Jimmy?
No, I can't.
Thank you. I've got to speak up for him. He's sitting there, yeah, girl,
thank you,
come
Robbie.
On.
Yeah. First time you ever did that.
Robbie's just trying to dissuade you other girls. She's in here.
That's right.
She's
I'm
in here massaging.
Lobbing for myself.
She's in here massaging Jimmy's ass during the commercials. All right, Robin, come on, wrap up a couple of stories.
All right, let's see what's going on here. First of all...
I'm
going
to pass out during your news because Jimmy's killing me.
You want me to leave Howard?
No, I feel bad.
You know, there is a new...
Walk through the bathroom.
Stop it! Stop it!
Yes. Oh, there's a new what?
Get up, Howard.
There's a new what?
There's a... What was I going to say? Now you made me lose my train of thought completely.
There's a new perfume on the market?
No.
That's all I can think
about. There's a new theater. The Paramount opened last night.
It's the Felt Forum.
Right, but they redid it somehow.
The Paramount. I played the Felt Forum. We did it, Robin. We played that.
Sure. But Barry Manilow opened it last night.
We sold out in an hour.
And they had a party, I guess, beforehand, and a tuxedoed Mayor David Dinkins joined Liza Minnelli.
What an idiot Dinkins is.
We're going to...
running around in a tuxedo.
Helen Gurley Brown.
Crown Heights is burning, and he's in a tuxedo.
Frank Gifford, and a much gawked over, according to this account, Kathy Lee Gifford.
Why is she gawked over?
I don't know, and a few hundred other VIPs.
She's becoming way too big a deal.
Yeah.
She's just some annoying beauty pageant loser.
I thought I'd point that out. A much gawked over Kathy Lee Gifford.
You want to gawk at our mayor? Because I tell you something, you wouldn't believe what he's done. All Kathy Lee's got is a big pair of Kimmy cans on her. Our mayor, he got elected and he cheated on his taxes. Now there's a guy to gawk over.
You're making him very upset, Jimmy. The National Federation for the Blind is upset over a portrayal of a blind character in a new ABC sitcom, Good and Evil. The character played by Mark Blankfield was created as a klutzy psychiatrist who has adjusted to his blindness in the aftermath of an accident. or who has not adjusted to his blindness in the aftermath of an accident. In last night's episode, he wrecked a lab with his cane.
Isn't that stupid? The blind people are upset that a guy who went blind in an accident isn't good at being blind. Of course he's not going to be. Of course he's going to wreck stuff.
The Association for the Blind says that this portrayal is irresponsible and ignorant and detrimental to all blind persons.
No, they can't see it anyway, so what are they worried about?
Who told them?
Right. It's like me. I was doing some goofy stuff on deaf people. Uh-huh. I go, which one of you squealed on me?
Well, anyway, so they're all up in arms about that ABC sitcom. They don't like it.
Yeah, like if all of a sudden you were blind, you would be...
You know, they scream, why aren't there more blind characters? We don't have any blind characters. And you give them a blind character, you go, get it off!
Right. It's not sensitive enough.
We don't like it. Donahue has heart transplant patients on today claiming that they've taken on their donor's personality.
I think we just had one in here.
Meanwhile, Oprah Winfrey will be entertaining Suzanne Somers and her family.
You think we're going to bring that possessed guy on the TV show that we just had in here?
I don't know. He didn't have much of a story.
Nah, he was kind of boring, actually. Just want to get into it.
Suzanne, you know, has done her own TV movie about growing up in an alcoholic family. So I guess that's what they'll be publicizing on the Oprah show. So she's dragging out the whole family again to tell them once again how they made her miserable.
Despicable.
While she was growing up.
Imagine that, pulling out our parents. Our old man had a drinking problem. He was a guy probably working his ass off. He had a few too many cocktails a couple of times. And right away, Suzanne Somers are dragging them all out and embarrassing them.
Yeah, so you can watch that again today.
That's going to be my dream. Mike, one day I'm going to be sitting at home, I'll be relaxing. I'll be about 65, 75 years old. I'll be in my condo in Florida with all the other yentas sitting there. And I'll be sitting there and going, oh, I remember Robin. Oh, she was so great to me. She went off with that sun bumper.
Oh.
And I'll be sitting there, I'll be rocking back and forth in my chair. And all of a sudden, I'll get a call.
Hello, Howard?
Yes?
Hi, your two daughters are on the show today. This is Geraldo.
Oh, hi, Geraldo. What's happening? What do you mean, my daughter? Oh, my daughter? What are you doing, a loving tribute to fatherhood?
No. They claim that because of you, they've been in the psychiatrist's office for the last 15 years because you're a crummy father and you were a goofy DJ and you embarrassed them as a child by having this profession.
Geraldo, what do you want? You want me to take a knife to my throat now? Is that it? You want me to kill myself? Would that please you?
We understand you used to drink as well.
Hey, I might have had a couple of cocktails. I didn't hurt anybody. It wasn't like I was driving around in my car.
We want to expose you.
Thank you.
We want to give you a chance to answer these charges.
Imagine your daughter writing a book like that. Jesus, that's the payback,
and then,
huh?
Now it's a TV movie, so they're going to have to watch it.
There's a girl, I don't know, you know, she leaves Three's Company, so she got to find something to do. She writes a book about her father. Be ashamed of herself.
Anyway, a vicious cop killer walked his last mile to the Georgia electric chair twice yesterday, Howard.
Yes.
In a bizarre death row mix-up. This Warren McCleskey, he was taken to walk down, I guess it's about a mile or something. They walk you down this long hallway.
Yeah.
And then they had the whole thing done. They had strapped him into the chair, shaved his head and legs.
He's walking still, Robin.
On him.
Keep going. It's a mile. There he goes.
And just with seconds left before they were about, there was a masked executioner there as well.
Yeah.
It's like a wrestling match.
Right.
A mask. Anyway. They were about to throw the switch. And that's when the warden learned, geez, we can get there already.
No, let him keep going. Yes?
The warden all of a sudden learned...
Oh, there he is.
...that there was a last-minute attempt at a stay. So they had to get him out of all this stuff and walk him back to his cell. And, of course, all the inmates started cheering and clapping and carrying on like the guy's life had been saved. But then a couple of hours later, they learned that the appeal had been denied.
Wow.
So they had to get him up, march him right back down the hall.
He's still going there the first time, according to Fred.
Wow.
And they strapped him in.
And shaved him. Fred, shave him. I just like to see him go for the effects. What?
Well, you need a couple of nice, clean spots to put those electrodes on.
Hey there, should we do the pubes, too? Yeah, why not? Give him a clean shave.
We could use some of my aftershave.
Yeah. He wanted to die after he smelled you, Jimmy.
And then he had... What was that for?
They opened his pants to shave him down there.
Oh, okay. Then he said a few last words.
Give me a little trim on that bush.
He asked his victim's family for forgiveness.
Oh, yeah, no problem there.
Advised his own family not to be resentful. And then he said, I pray that one day in this country, supposedly a civilized society, they will abolish barbaric acts such as the death penalty.
Yeah, but like how about we abolish barbaric acts like going around killing people?
Yeah, killing cops is pretty bad. Remember, this is not the end for me. It is the beginning. I have hoped for to be in the presence of my Lord.
Put a TV dinner in his lap, cook it up while he's frying so the electricity doesn't go to waste.
Well, then the power was thrown. His body surged forward and a puff of smoke rose from the area around his head.
Oh, he just went to the bathroom in his pants. I heard it. There he goes.
And now he's no longer with us.
Good. One less maniac on the planet.
The Food and Drug Administration...
They had to scrape him off the chair and slide him into his grave.
Food and Drug Administration has told manufacturers they must provide doctors with information. Stop that. Scraping him off the chair.
We got every sound of it. And then he put him in a rocket ship to Mars.
It's in a time capsule.
Yeah. They put him in a rocket ship to send him off the planet.
All right, enough.
All right, go ahead.
The FDA, Food and Drug Administration, has told manufacturers that they must provide doctors with information about the risks of breast implants, written in a language that patients can understand.
And, you know, the patients going in for breast implants, that's got to be pretty simple language. How many go-go dancers understand what's written on this piece of paper? How many go-go dancers can read?
I didn't realize this, but each year about 150,000 women undergo implant surgery. 80% of them simply for enlargement.
You could tell a woman who wants big breasts, you know, these go-go dancers, you could tell them, hey, you can get cancer. They all know already. You can get cancer. Put them in. Put them in. Life isn't worth living without big knockers. What's the matter with them?
Well, every day so far this week, we've had a new breast implant story.
Meanwhile, Kimberly Taylor's walking around.
Finally this morning, Howard.
Yes?
There is a man who's suing the people who make Arm & Hammer baking soda because he claims that he took the baking soda for indigestion.
Right.
And it caused an explosion in his stomach. And he wound up having to have 6 operations to recover from this incident.
Wow. Well, that's a good lawsuit.
He said...
I'm sure someone will take that lawsuit.
He said that he had had a bowl of homemade chili, 2 martinis, and a glass of wine.
Mm. Wait a second. A bowl of chili, 2 martinis, and a glass of wine, and the baking soda made his stomach explode.
Then, I guess he went to sleep, and he woke up with indigestion.
Okay.
Remembering a remedy his grandmother told him about, he put a spoonful of baking soda in a glass of water and drank it. Now, he says... that the baking soda caused an explosion in his stomach that nearly...
Yeah. It caused...
And he's the editor of National Geographic magazine. But anyway, he's asking $1.5 million from the Arm & Hammer Baking Soda Company.
That's chicken feed. Why doesn't he go for $100 billion?
And they say hundreds of millions of people have taken billions of doses under all kinds of circumstances and never had this happen to them. Meanwhile, doctors did tell this man that the tear in his stomach was caused by a perforated ulcer. But years later, he came to believe the baking soda was the culprit and filed a lawsuit. So this is being entertained in a court in...
Let me tell you something about how stupid people are.
New Brunswick, New Jersey.
Don't, if you got a stomach ache, you know what you got to do? You don't take baking soda. You stop eating all the junk that you eat. Baking soda ain't going to cure your stomach ache. You know, when you got a stomach ache, you know what that means? Don't put anything else into your stomach. Don't put more things into your stomach. Why don't you use your common sense?
baking soda. You don't even know what's in baking soda. People swallow anything. Except my wife. She seems to be particular. Go ahead, Robin.
Oh, I'm finished. That's what's
all right. Very good. We got to get out of here. Let me have those plugs. It's great. You eat like you eat a live rat and then you say something feels weird. Chili and wine and kind of stuff. Don't put baking soda in there. Use your head.
Oh, one of the munchkins is dead, Howard.
Screw him.
Oh, stop it.
Jackie Penhouse, Joke Page, Martling tonight. Big show. A night of Stump the Joke Man.
Angelo Rosato.
Yeah, sure.
He was 33 inches tall. He was in The Wizard of Oz.
My arm is 35 inches long. I take a 35 sleeve, you know that?
Really?
Yeah.
Your arm is longer than this man was tall.
What kind of life could he have been living?
He was in Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome.
Oh, great. What'd he play, a midget?
You remember that those two guys? There was a big guy and a little guy who was master.
Right,
he was the little guy.
Yeah, great role. tough role.
He was a regular on H.R. Puffin. Stump, this guy had a lot of credit.
Good. Great role.
He was 83 years old. I didn't know little people lived to be that long.
Wow, that's great. Jokey the Man, Martling. Tonight, big show. Tonight is Stump the Joke Man, Roscoe's Comedy Hour. Robin, you love Stump the Joke Man.
Oh, of course I do.
From West Orange, New Jersey, for jokes and information.
I think I might go.
516-922-Y next Wednesday, October 2nd, at Bananas Comedy Club in the Fort Lee Holiday Inn. It's fun to spend an evening with Jackie in Fort Lee, New Jersey. Boy Gary, this Saturday at RKO Home Video on Broadway at 49th. From noon to 2, Doors Home Video Giveaways. Don't miss our own Stuttering John at the Hop in Totowa, New Jersey tonight.
I don't know why you're plugging
him. Hero of the Stupid.
I shouldn't plug him?
That was Lester. Hold on.
He didn't show up today.
Oh, then. Well, then no plug.
Give him his plug.
Long Island Rock Rehearsals presents Josie Tsang at Players Cafe in North Massapequa, Long Island, this Friday night, September 27th. The world's largest tailgate party and walkathon takes place on Sunday, October 20th at Giant Stadium, sponsored by 92.3 K-Rock. You can call 1-800-388-5588 for information. If you're planning a wedding or party and want a mobile DJ, call Scott the Engineer's Rocket Entertainment at 718-BAG-5040. And don't forget to plan your Christmas party early. At some point, I run out of wind. All right, we going to play some of Jimmy's commercials? Or
we can play.
Where is Meg? Boy, she gets more time off than any disc jockey I ever heard of.
We should get on her schedule.
You're not kidding. I'm in the wrong business. I got to get in her business. Okay. Are you going to play spots or are we going to
play
song?
A tune.
A tune?
Sure.
All right. Bet you it's going to be Neil Young.
Let's see.
Told you. All right. That's Vanilla Fudge, right?
Rod Stewart.
Hey. Let's see what's on this one. Nothing. All right, I'll go with this. This is Rod Stewart. At 92.3 K-Rock, WYSP, WJFK, and of course, Los Angeles now. Our empire grows. Very lovely, stinky Jimmy Fink, isn't he? He's so perfumed, it's unbelievable.
I got a headache.
You have a headache from smelling yourself.
Yeah, I know.
I'm just killing time to get to that all-important talk-up. Yeah. This is a long one. This could go on forever. Rock and Rod Stewart, that 92.3 K-Rock, WYSP, WJFK. Boy, I tell you something, it's been raining the last couple of days, but our reservoirs are still empty. Looking at that water alert. How's that?
Not good.
What do you mean? Bull.
You were in the middle of a sentence.
No, looking at that water alert. Boom. You're always in the middle of a sentence. That's the point. How was that, Jimmy? You liked it, right?
Right to the post.
Right to the post. It doesn't matter where you end up.
Oh, yeah.